Welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's 14th meeting of 2021. I've received no apologies for this morning's meeting. We do have a number of members joining us virtually though. Our first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 3 in private. Are members agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. Our second item today is an evidence session with stakeholders as part of our short inquiry into perinatal mental health. And all our witnesses this morning are joining us remotely. And a welcome to the committee. We've got Selena Gledel-Ware, the perinatal faculty chair of the Royal College of Psychiatrists. We've got Mary Ross Davey, the director for Scotland's Royal College of Midwives. Dr. Aaron Chopra, the executive director of Mental Welfare Commission. And Professor Marion Knight, the Professor of Maternal and Child Population Health for Embrace. What I was going to do is, first of all, I'd like to ask a question of all our panellists and go round you all, just to get your views, just to kick things off. And then my colleagues will ask you questions on themes, and they will probably direct their initial question to someone in particular. But then if others want to come in it, if you can maybe, on the platform that you're logged into, if you could use the chat box and just put an R or a request to speak in the chat box so that I can see it and then I'll know to come to you. And that means that you're not sitting there with lots to say and I'm not noticing you. That seems to be the way that we're able to manage things in this hybrid situation. So I was wanting to ask you all, in terms of what needs to be done in two ways. One, what needs to be focused on in the short and medium term in perinatal mental health care. Obviously, we've got the backdrop of COVID, and we will come on to COVID specifically. But what your view is that what needs to be done in the short and medium term? And a supplementary question to that, what needs to be done to ensure consistency of good practice and good service across the whole of Scotland? So if I go down my list of you all in the order in which I introduced you all, if I go to Selena first of all. Could we unmute?
Representing the Royal College. Can you hear me?
We can hear you now. On you go.
Well, thank you for inviting me today here, convener, representing the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland perinatal faculty. I think you've raised a very kind of valuable and pertinent question that we need to think carefully about. In Scotland, as you've mentioned, we're not only addressing the developing services that the need was highlighted prior to the pandemic, but also the need for services to have that support and resilience to recover from the pandemic. So I think there are a number of key themes that are required to for the short and medium term, primarily workforce support and development, both in terms of recruitment, as some services have faced delays in recruitment due to the pandemic, but also that we may need additional resource as the workforce has been stretched during the COVID pandemic, and we know staff wellbeing has faced particular challenge. So we need to think nationally, how do we support the increased recruitment and retention of the specialist perinatal workforce, also across the different tiers of the perinatal pathway? Alongside this, we need to think about the infrastructure that services need. So services need safe spaces in which they can work to deliver safe and effective care to women and their families. If we think that about how services have responded to the pandemic, they've had to be very nimble in adapting to the blended working environment of both remote and face-to-face working. And whilst this has increased access to care for some populations, we know that there are particular groups in the population that may still have particular barriers to access to care. That may be those excluded digitally, those on low incomes, those experiencing domestic violence, or particular vulnerable populations, such as women affected by substance misuse, our diverse communities, particularly where there might be language barriers, literacy challenges, sensory impairment or disability needs that might disadvantage access to care or contribute to experiences of discrimination or delay in access to care. So we particularly need to make sure that our service developments support the most vulnerable in our population, so we do not exacerbate any pre-existing inequalities in care that we know have been likely increasing during the pandemic. Alongside that, we need to think how specialist services can support universal services and across the kind of joined up care pathways. We've welcomed the investment from the Scottish Government, both with perinatal specialist community and MBU services, but also maternal and neonatal psychological interventions and infant mental health services. So we need sustained, protected investment across these areas to ensure that we do not roll back on the gains that we've made and that we try to consolidate and make continue kind of robust progress of change. We know that failure to do this, unfortunately, will lead to adverse outcomes for not only women, but also their infants and family networks. So in summary, I think there's a range of supports and interventions required, both in terms of workforce planning, recruitment, estate provision, ensuring joined up care pathways, and ensuring that staff wellbeing is supported. I think we are fortunate that we have the managed clinical network, which I think can help with consistent high quality standards. They and the support for the professional groups delivering these services, but continued investment that's protected is required.
Thank you. And can I come to Mary Ross-Davey?
Yes, thank you very much for inviting me today. I'm Dr. Mary Ross-Davey, and I'm a Director of Professional Midwifery with the Royal College of Midwives, and I was previously the Director for Scotland for the Royal College of Midwives. I've also previously been a perinatal mental health specialist midwife in the past, so I have a particular interest in this field. I think the first thing to note is the significant investment made by the Scottish Government in this area over the last years that we've really welcomed. And there's been a huge amount of work, as Selena has identified, with the national network, which has definitely really helped move things forward. The pandemic has had an impact on the pace that those developments can go ahead, and that needs to be acknowledged and real restoration. And I think Selena's absolutely right, the need to focus on staff wellbeing. But us in midwifery, we work very much at that interface between universal services, but we also have a role in specialist perinatal mental health services as well. And we need to have consistent investment in midwives to be able to provide really evidence-based, high-quality perinatal mental health support. And that is a universal service as well as a specialist service. So we need midwives who have the time and the skills and training to be able to provide support adequately during pregnancy. So that involves time and training to really focus on prevention of the development of significant mental health problems, to support women and families' well-being during pregnancy. One of the approaches to that is definitely continuity of carer. That is one of the mainstays of maternity policy in Scotland, but that's also been delayed partly by the pandemic, but also significantly affected by a shortage of midwives, a chronic shortage of midwives across Scotland, which needs to be addressed urgently. I think the other area for focus in terms of midwifery support is as Selena was identifying, the need for specialist facilities where services can be provided for women with very acute illness, and to ensure that women continue to receive midwifery support to normalise as far as possible their experiences. Another key area is the prevention of ill health, and one significant area of perinatal mental ill health is PTSD, so post-traumatic stress disorder from childbirth experiences. We have now in Scotland very few consultant midwives, only two consultant midwives working in Scotland. And consultant midwives have a really key role in having birth reflection clinics, talking to women about traumatic birth experiences and preparing them for subsequent birth. So I think that's an area that sits in universal services that's really key to focus on the recruitment and development of consultant midwives across Scotland. Thanks very much.
Thank you. That's very helpful. And I think my colleagues will dig into some of what you've brought up there in more detail. Can I come to Aaron Chopra?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm from the Mental Welfare Commission, and the Commission is part of the assurance mechanism to ensure that mental health services are working well for people of Scotland. And two critical ways in which we do this are through visiting the settings where people are liable to be receiving mental health services, and also through monitoring the Mental Health Act and promoting best practice with regards to that. So it's on the basis of those two things that I'd like to make some observations in response to your question about the short term. But to start, I think I'd echo the point that Mary just made, and the Commission very much welcomes the additional funding that's gone towards perinatal mental health services. And through our visiting function to mother and baby units, and in speaking to those who deliver services, we can really see the impact that's already having in helping people. I'd also echo the point that Selena made around staffing and well-being of staff. The pandemic has put pressures on the health and social care sector like never before, which I think we all know about. Having said that, I think there are things that we could do to improve things in the short term. One of those things is around, and this actually fits very well with your supplementary question around consistency, is about having clear pathways. And this is something which the Embrace report spoke to, about clear, explicit pathways into perinatal mental health care. And I think if we had those clear, explicit pathways into mental health care, that would make an improvement. It would remove any uncertainty about what women and their families might need to expect. Another thing that I'd like to add to what we've heard already is around monitoring and data. And the Commission has a role around monitoring the Act, and we've got some of the most progressive legislation in the world. We've got some absolutely fundamental, brilliant ideas around ensuring women are offered the chance to be admitted with their baby. And yet we don't always have the required notification systems to make sure that that's being delivered. So I think there's work that we can do around data and monitoring. We might pick that up later. I think it's also important to ensure that staffing is on a secure footing. I think training is vital, and not just within specialist perinatal services, because often people are engaging with other parts of the mental health system, whether that's the primary care, whether that's secondary care, general adult mental health services, or whether that's even CAMHS services, because that's something else which has come through in the Embrace report about younger women. So I think that's important. And crisis teams or IHTTs, ensuring that their staff have knowledge about the particular challenges and the particular risk assessments around the perinatal period. I think that would make a difference. I'd also say in the short term, as we recover and restore, we need to think about equity, and we need to think about equitable access to all parts of the perinatal system. And whether that's for women who misuse substances, or whether it's for women coming from more socioeconomically deprived backgrounds or minoritized ethnic communities, I think there's an opportunity for us in the short term to build back better. I think it's also probably important to, and this goes back to the very first point about consistency and pathways, is to actually make sure that we have a very clear national service specification that operates across Scotland, so people can know exactly what to expect And that will provide a really good benchmark for organisations like ours to assess how things are progressing. I'll stop at that point. Thank you.
Thank you. Again, very, very helpful for my colleagues to dig in deeper. And finally, on this question, Marion Knight.
Thank you very much. And I guess I was obviously going to pick up on a number of points that Aaron just made. For those of you who are not aware, Embrace is the organisation that has responsibility for investigating the care of all women who die during pregnancy or up to a year after the end of pregnancy. And just to put that in context, maternal suicide is the leading direct cause of death in the period 6 weeks to a year after the end of pregnancy. And if we're thinking about substance misuse and suicide together, they represent more than a third of maternal deaths in that period. So perinatal mental health is absolutely crucially important to preventing maternal deaths. And the overwhelming theme that we see when we're investigating the care of women who died is actually gaps in the services. So the number one short-term thing for me is to minimise those gaps in the services. And they include a variety of themes. So there may be thresholds so that women are denied access to specialist services because they're considered not ill enough, which essentially is to do with capacity of those specialist services. So we do need to make sure that the specialist services have sufficient capacity to accept referrals, which may be at a lower threshold in the perinatal period. It's also important when we're thinking about exclusions on the basis of diagnosis, and particularly women with comorbid conditions. So too often we see that substance misuse services won't accept referrals of women with mental health problems, and mental health services won't accept referrals of women with substance misuse problems. So if you have both, where do you go? And I guess the other big theme for me, which is not, that's a big gap in perinatal services, and I imagine Clear Harmer will talk about this later, is thinking about women who've experienced a loss event. We know that a loss event, and by that I don't just mean a miscarriage or a baby death, stillbirth or neonatal death, I also mean child removal. We know that that makes women extremely vulnerable. And yet perinatal mental health services don't typically accept women who have had a loss event, and yet they have all of the needs for perinatal mental health care of women who have living babies. So bridging that gap and ensuring that the pathways are able to cope with the needs of all individuals is the number one thing for me that we need to think about in the short term. And I think, as Aaron mentioned, having a service specification that means that those pathways are very clear and the communication between the different services means that those gaps no longer exist, I think, is going to be one of the most important actions.
Thank you for that. There's lots for us to think about. There's what I do want to pick up before I hand over to my colleagues on one thing that was mentioned, which I obviously was aware of as being an issue, that the government and the policy around the continuity of care, and you know, for example, knowing that when you go into labour that you're the midwife, it's not going to be someone that you've never met before, is something that, as you say, is still to be rolled out. Can I ask any of you, just raise your hand if you want to come in first, in terms of the practical aspect of that, given what you've said about shortages of midwives, I know it's not going to be easy. I'm not asking how easy that is to roll out. But is that something that we think that is going to be doable within the next couple of years as we come out of the pandemic? And could you maybe reflect on the importance of why, in terms of mental health, that could make a difference, having that continuity of midwife? midwifery care. And Mary Ross-Davey wants to come in. Mary.
Thank you very much, and thanks for focusing on this really key area. We do have real concerns about the practical implementation of continuity of carer at the moment, with the significant shortages of midwives and the huge pressures that the pandemic has brought. I think there are a number of ways that we can make that happen more effectively than we have so far. I think greater investment, focused, ring-fenced investment in the implementation of continuity of care is needed. There has been less investment in that regard than there has been actually focused on perinatal mental health. So I think that's one key area. When you're implementing such a significant service-wide change, it's really important that there's ring-fenced investment in the process and in the leadership of that process. And as mentioned earlier, we have a lack of consultant midwives in Scotland that could have a real role in implementing that service change. I think another area that we need to focus on is ensuring that continuity of carer, if we can't go whole hog all at one time, that we need to focus on those women who are particularly vulnerable of having poor outcomes. And in this regard, women who are vulnerable to mental health problems are key. So I think what we need to do initially is focus the implementation of continuity of carer teams. So midwives generally, when we're implementing continuity of carer, will work in small teams. So that enables women to get to know their midwives really well during the pregnancy and have a much higher chance of having a midwife that they know with them during labour. And that's particularly important for women with mental health issues. So the implementation should focus on those women with particular needs and also women with living with deprivation who have much poorer outcomes that Marion will be able to speak to very well, and women, black and brown women, and women from ethnic minorities as well. We need to make sure that we focus the implementation of continuity in those areas first, but real ring-fenced investment is required to make this happen.
Thank you, that's helpful. Can I come to Marion Knight then?
And just when we think about the women who die, a majority of those women have complex adversity. So they're women who have had adverse childhood experiences. They're women who are victims of domestic abuse. There may be substance misuse and social services involvement. And to ensure the best outcomes for them, a trusted therapeutic relationship, somebody who you really trust, who can help you navigate the system, be your advocate, is absolutely crucially important. But the main point I wanted to make, and I would agree with Mary, that focusing on those vulnerable groups is really important. But the midwives will need training. They will need training to be to have the specialist skills to be working with these extremely vulnerable groups of women. So it's not just the continuity of carer model, it's the continuity of carer model with specialist trained teams.
Thank you, that's very helpful. Can I move on? My colleague Evelyn Tweed wants to come in on questions around funding. Evelyn, over to you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I would like to ask a question around mother and baby units. I see that there's only a couple in Scotland. Do you think we need more mother and baby units? And could I ask Dr. Chopra, please?
Thank you. I think it's a good opportunity for me to drill down a little bit into what we found through our visiting function for the two mother and baby units, and that will help to build up to the question around whether we need additional resources So, as I mentioned in my introduction, the Commission visits both the mother and baby units to see how they're working and to understand the experience of women and families who are using those services. And we were very encouraged with what we saw in our last visit to the west of Scotland, and we've got a visit coming up to St John's in Livingston early next year. We've seen improvements in terms of staffing, in terms of ability to have parent infant mental health nurses. We've seen improvements in peer support workers. This is also coming online. And we also saw really good care plans. And the reason perhaps around this is because of the fact that women are being admitted to these two units. However, one of the things that we have seen quite clearly is that there is a difference in the rates of admissions to these mother and baby units based on health boards. So if your health board has a mother and baby unit, you are more likely to have admissions coming from that. So to put numbers around this, so for example, Lothian, NHS Lothian and NHS GGNC, Greater Glasgow and Clyde, have rates of admissions above 3 per 1,000 births to their units. Whereas if you look at other health boards, the numbers are lower. They're kind of sometimes 2 per 1,000 or sometimes lower than that. So the availability of a mother and baby unit leads to a greater awareness of what that mother and baby unit will offer to the mother and to the infant. So that's quite clear from the data that we're seeing. When we looked at the reasons for why sometimes mothers were not admitted with their babies to mother and baby units, but were admitted to general adult wards, one of the things that became quite clear to us is sometimes it was choice. Other times it was about particular disadvantages. So if you if travel's an issue or if childcare's an issue, they would be factors, distances that people needed to travel. But another factor that would come into it is a lack of awareness from the referring unit about the advantages that a mother and baby unit might provide. So I think that also came through to us quite clearly, both when we did this work in 2015, 2016, and more recently when we've been discussing what the reasons might be around people not being admitted to mother and baby units when they should. A question that then arises, and this comes onto your question, is whether there ought to be a greater provision. When they did delivering, when the network looked at delivering effective services, there was an estimate that Scotland would probably require around 16 beds, and currently we have 12 beds. So there was a question about whether we need greater provision. And we were in contact with NHS Grampian, who provided us an update on the number of admissions that they've had from the north to the units. And they provided a number around, I think it was about 9 per year. That doesn't fit with our modelling, which would suggest that the numbers might be higher. But if you remember what I was saying about the awareness actually leads to a greater number of admissions. So that brings on to the idea around an options appraisal about whether we ought to create more beds in the north, perhaps a bespoke unit, 4 beds, at least, because I think you need a critical number in order to develop the infrastructure, the staffing, the knowledge, the skills, or whether it might be better to use that to build that resource into the existing mother and baby units. So I think what we need to see now is a detailed options appraisal. And my understanding is that that is coming in early 2022, but I think that will be critical to make a decision about whether we whether there's a new unit up in the north, or whether we might want to increase provisions in the two existing mother and baby units.
Evelyn, I believe that Selina Gledaware wants to come in.
Oh, thank you. I would just echo Dr. Chopra's submission there, really, that members have highlighted at times it can be difficult to admit to the mother and baby units, particularly bed availability can be stretched, although this does fluctuate over the course of the year. And as Dr. Chopra has highlighted, geographical barriers do disproportionately affect those women in more remote and rural kind of living areas. I think as Dr. Chopra has highlighted, careful consideration is required as to the location of where these additional beds should be, and particularly that also feeds back into the kind of staffing, recruitment and retention issue. To have a sustainable, safe and effective mother and baby unit, you're going to need a much larger pool of specialist trained workforce. If, for example, units are to be developed in areas where they do not currently exist. So we're very appreciative of the work that the programme board, Perinatal Infant Health Programme Board, is doing in terms of the options appraisal. And as a faculty, we'll be very keen to see the results of that. Thank you.
Thank you. Evelyn, have you got another question?
Yes, convener. Can I also ask the panel which areas of perinatal mental health services would also benefit from further investment? And could I ask maybe Mary Ross Davey, please?
Yes, thank you, Evelyn, for that question. I think you won't be surprised that I would say we need further investment in universal services. And in prevention, and the focus there is on making sure that we have a midwifery workforce that is adequate, that is appropriately trained and appropriately supported to do the work. Unfortunately, so often when there are reports around perinatal mental health, midwifery is sidelined or not centred in the descriptions of what that service could look like. We believe that it is absolutely key that every health board in Scotland has a specialist perinatal mental health midwife. They are a really key link between universal services and specialist services, and really making sure that those services are able to speak to each other and that any pathways of care are really appropriate for the universal services and relevant. They also have a really important role in ensuring training of midwives in the local area and providing that midwifery input where women are admitted to mother and baby units or needing more specialist care. And unfortunately, that wasn't a key centred recommendation from the initial plans for the perinatal mental health services. So I think there's a lot to do in terms of ensuring that midwifery input is centred. Also, what we've seen in the pandemic is that it has been midwives who have continued to go out in person throughout, and where other services have become virtual, midwives have needed to step into those positions and ensure that support for women with mental health problems is provided in person on occasion. So that's put particular stress on the midwifery workforce, but it's also identified how key it is that we make sure that midwifery workforce is adequate and adequately prepared and trained and supported to provide that care. Thank you.
Can I bring in Professor Knight?
Thank you. I just wanted to emphasise the importance of the non-specialist services, because a recurrent message that we've identified is the lack of training, lack of understanding of perinatal mental ill health amongst crisis liaison and home treatment teams. So it's really important that actions are not just focused on the specialist perinatal mental health teams. Because many women will be seen initially by a crisis or liaison or home treatment team, and yet they frequently don't particularly understand the rapidity with which mental health can deteriorate in the perinatal period. And too often we see symptoms dismissed and yet women get very ill very quickly. So it's just to emphasise that we also need to make sure that we're training our non-specialist teams about the particular features and need for urgent care amongst women who've got perinatal mental ill health.
Thank you. And can I come to Dr. Chopra?
Thank you. I echo the points that Mary and Marion have just made. The additional point I wanted to briefly make was around the voluntary sector and ensuring that statutory services pathways also make reference to where we can use and people may benefit from voluntary sector involvement, because I think they're a hugely important piece of the puzzle here. But thank you.
Thank you. And Dr. Gledelweir wants to come in as well.
Thank you. I would like to highlight the role of the specialist and professionals, particularly psychiatrists, in supporting universal health care professionals to have that specialist awareness, to be able to pick up those vulnerable women who maybe do need that enhanced support, who can do the teaching and training with the intensive home treatment teams, the crisis teams, the health visitors, the GPs. And that's why we need, I guess, the investment in supporting them to be a resilient workforce, so that can be benefits across the whole pathway, because we do need that expert knowledge to be shared, as Professor Knight has really helpfully highlighted. The other areas that the faculty would like to highlight that have already been mentioned this morning that probably do warrant additional assessment and potential investment is the care pathways of women who have substance misuse difficulties. They've not traditionally fallen within perinatal psychiatric services. And as yet, there is no specific national care pathway for them, although there are examples of good practice across Scotland. This is by no means implemented across Scotland, and particularly given that they are at increased risk of maternal death and adverse outcomes for their infants and families. I think this is an area that warrants attention, particularly given the context in Scotland of our particularly high rates of deaths due to alcohol and substance misuse. As has already been made kind of evident this morning, also the experience of women who've had loss events, and traditionally these women have not been kind of part of perinatal services, but I think perinatal specialist services do have advice to give perhaps universal or voluntary sector pathways in the support that could be provided to them, and where, for example, they may then require more specialist perinatal mental health interventions, but many of them may benefit from you know, more universal or voluntary sector support in the first instance. So those are particular areas of need that I think may require further attention. We also do need to consolidate the work of the kind of existing pathways, as we're still in the very early stages of those being robustly implemented across Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. Stephanie Callaghan wanted to come in with a supplementary question on this issue. Stephanie.
Thank you very much, Gillian, and hello to the panel this morning. It was Professor Knight that my question was for. You mentioned earlier on about baby loss and babies actually being removed from mums, and that being included there too. Now, I know that quite high numbers of care experienced mums lose their babies at birth or very, very soon after birth as well. You know, they haven't had that those stable and protective relationships themselves. And quite often there's that perceived... Oh, the screen's disappeared. I don't know if we're still on.
We are still on.
Sorry, quite often there's that perceived risk of significant harm to the baby. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are on, you know, would for example, there we again, would for example expanding access to mother and baby units be helpful to offer support to those mums and help them keep their babies? Or what other perinatal health services could we look at that would actually maybe be a positive support to those mums and keep families together? Thanks.
Hopefully you've all heard that. I think we're having a wee bit of dropout from time to time. You addressed that in particular to Professor Knight, is that correct? Professor Knight, were you able to hear all of that?
I hope I heard most of the question. It broke up for us a couple of times. I think if I understood the question, it was that children are often removed from mother's care for their own protection, and it's whether there was additional support needed at that stage or additional family support. Was that the gist of the question?
Yes. So, So in particular, the high numbers of care experienced mums who lose their children at birth or very close to birth. So would mother and baby unit expansion be something that would support that, or what other perinatal services could help keep those babies with their mums? Thanks.
I'm probably not the best person to comment on mother and baby units. There is a very definite pattern for me that women are, the children are removed and then all focus on the mother is gone. So the mother then has no support. So it's often a very valid decision around child protection. But then the mother has no support. So effectively, the rug is pulled out from under her feet, and she's had very intensive support throughout pregnancy. The child is removed, and then all support for her goes. And that's the gap that for me is really important to fill in, to ensure that those women continue to get the support they need, whether or not their children are at home with them.
Thank you. And Mary Ross-Davey wants to come in.
Thank you. Yes, I think there's very patchy provision in Scotland in this regard. There are some really great examples of specialist teams where midwives work in conjunction with social work and child protection and health visitors to provide a really wraparound service for women that are identified as being particularly vulnerable and where there are concerns around safeguarding. So women with severe mental health problems, women who are care experienced, who have substance misuse problems, a learning disability. So in Fife, there's a great team. But what we have seen is that where there have been really good examples, for example, in the Borders in the past, that those services haven't received consistent, sustained funding, and that they're often seen as a short-term project, and then that funding is removed or time is needed to be spent to try and seek additional funding for those teams. So I think it needs to be seen as an integral part of what we provide in terms of maternity care across Scotland, that we have these specialist teams where midwives have particular training and expertise, and they are working within these multidisciplinary, multi-agency teams to really provide support for women and to prevent babies being removed where possible. And we've certainly seen cases where that has been the case. If you have these specialist teams, that you see fewer babies needing to be removed because those women and families have that additional support during pregnancy, but also in the postnatal period where you have family support workers who are able to go out several times a day in those first weeks and months to provide that really focused support, and that can lead to safe environments for those babies. But that certainly isn't provided consistently across the country and certainly doesn't seem to be factored into the overall maternity policy. Thank you.
Dr. Gledelware wants to come in.
Thank you. I would echo the points just made. There are certainly some examples of good practice, and we know, for example, early intervention and preventative work to prevent relapse of mental health illness can make a big difference, and that's a big part of the work that specialist community perinatal teams do, in particularly care coordination with midwives, social workers and health visitors to try and ensure as much support is around women and families, prevent relapse and prevent that impacting on the infant. We've also seen areas of good practice in substance misuse, those such as the PREPARE team in NHS Lothian. Again, they have very early preventative work to engage the hardest to reach women with chaotic substance misuse with input from, you know, maternity, health visiting and social care, an integrated model of care that continues with women during that antenatal and postnatal period. But unfortunately, this remains the exception rather than the rule. I think there is a need to look at the social care supports that these women and their families need, particularly around parenting support and provision. And certainly during the pandemic, we've really seen that statutory services have really often had to prioritise the highest tariff cases, but there's not been that scope to do the early and preventative work that could help ensure that women and their family and their infants remain together. I would also just to highlight the point that mother and baby units are for the provision of acute psychiatric care to women who are acutely mentally unwell and their infants. When there's a clear determination that mother will be the main carer of the infant, and this is separate from a mother and baby unit that would be a parenting assessment that would be determining whether a mother would be able to meet the needs of her infant. And I guess we've seen in the social care environment that those parenting assessment units have in Scotland generally been moved into more community-based provision that, as I've mentioned, I think the pandemic has significantly challenged. So I think that's an important distinction for the committee to understand in terms of the role and remit of specialist psychiatric mother and baby units compared to the kind of broader remit of a parenting assessment unit. Thank you.
Thank you. Before we delve into workforce issues that you've all mentioned, I just wanted to ask Mary Ross-Davey for something. I mean, we have spoken to some parents who have had mental health issues as a result of pregnancy and childbirth, and one of them mentioned something to me that I wasn't aware of. Additional support midwife, had support from an additional support midwife when her during pregnancy it was established that she needed that extra care. But on the problem further, I realised additional support midwives aren't available throughout Scotland. Is that your experience? Are you able to sort of shed any light onto, you know, where this is happening? It sounds like good practice to me that an additional support midwife is given to somebody who they know that they're going to have some particular difficulty.
Absolutely. Obviously, there are different titles that are given to midwives who work in this particular field and in this way, providing additional support to women who have been identified as having particular needs. So in some areas, they're called a SNPs midwife, special needs in pregnancy service. And in the past, they used to be called Sure Start midwives when there was Sure Start funding. But actually, you know, whatever the title, I think what is vital is that we identify those women who do have particular support needs and that we do provide additional midwifery support to them from a known midwife. As Marion mentioned earlier, it's so key for women and families who haven't had positive experiences in their lives in terms of their relationships with health, with social care, with authority figures, that they can build a relationship of trust with a midwife. It's a great point of entry in terms of building a relationship of trust with authority and health figures. So for a midwife to be able to provide consistent presence and support during the pregnancy is absolutely vital. And you're right, it's patchy. It doesn't exist in every area. And I think the focus over the last at least 10 years has very much been on trying to have midwives generally across the service providing universal care rather than really identifying the benefit of those kind of specialist roles, because midwives working in those areas do need additional training to provide really high quality care around perinatal health, mental health, substance misuse, around safeguarding. Not every midwife is going to be able to provide that high quality care in that area. So I think it is about let's make sure that we have those specialist services in every health board in Scotland and have consistent long-term funding for those services.
Thank you. That's really helpful. Can I pass over to Gillian Mackay?
Thank you, convener. Is the panel satisfied that sufficient long-term workforce planning is taking place to ensure Scotland has the perinatal mental health workforce it needs? And could I come to Mary Ross-Davey with that, please?
Thank you. There is a focus on workforce planning, and there is increased work to make sure that our workforce planning tools in maternity are fit for purpose and reflect the direction of travel in maternity services. Previously, the workforce planning tools that we've had in maternity focused very much on acute care, seeing maternity as being generally provided in obstetric units in maternity hospitals. But maternity care is much more than that. It crosses into community. In fact, it's largely provided in community settings by midwives. There's a huge amount of work that's done in primary care and in conjunction with other services. So I think there are improvements being made in that regard, but there's much more to be done to make sure that we've got that long-term planning, to make sure that we've got the right professionals in the right place. We did see a huge drop in the number of student midwives in Scotland from 2011. And we've been working ever since then to try and address that, to make sure that we have enough student midwives coming through and being trained across Scotland. I think there is still an issue about being able to attract student midwives, particularly in the north of Scotland and in remote and rural areas, and there's still a need to address that. There are only three universities in Scotland that are providing pre-registration midwifery education. I think there was a real opportunity provided in Inverness over recent years with a pilot project to provide a shortened programme for student midwives. And we do want to see the new shortened programme that's being provided from Napier University really encourage that remote and rural development. So people who have been nurses in the past can then take a shortened programme to become midwives. So there is more to be done. There are positive green shoots in that regard. I think the other key factor is that we retain the experienced midwives that we have, and not enough is being done in that regard. So we can't just have student midwives coming through and newly qualified midwives. We need to retain the very experienced midwives in the service by offering them decent working conditions and flexible working opportunities, which again isn't being done consistently everywhere. Thank you.
Does the panel more widely have concerns about workforce morale and well-being and how this will impact on retention? I know Mary Ross-Davey said there a wee bit about focusing on recruitment and retention, but is there too much of a focus, do you feel, just now on recruitment and not enough on retention more widely?
Dr. Chopper would like to come in. There we go.
Thank you. I think it's important to focus both on recruitment and retention. I'd like to speak to some of the Commission's work. I mean, we operate an advice line for professionals and for people with lived experience and their families to phone the Commission when they have particular issues around their care and how the Act is being used or the law is being used. And we take about 4,500 phone calls a year. So we get a sense of what's happening through that, as well as through our visiting and monitoring function. And one thing that is coming through is the complexity of what people are working with and the lack of resource. And just to put some numbers on that, I mean, at the sharper end of the mental health and mental illness continuum, year on year, there's usually a 5% rise in the number of people who've been detained under the Mental Health Act in Scotland. Last year in the COVID period, and we published this data in July, we showed there was a 10% rise. So it's almost a doubling of the people with more severe illnesses. And I think that's kind of being echoed through the system in that there's been an increase in anxiety, there's been an increase in particular conditions like eating disorders and OCD, which have relevance to the perinatal population as well. So I think what we're seeing, just to bring a broader perspective to place perinatal within, from the Commission's monitoring data and from our advice line, is a workforce under pressures that they haven't seen before. And that makes it really important for us to see how the Act and how care is delivered when the workforce are having particular difficulties. Yes, it's important to train more people and recruitment, but I think what we're also looking to see across the professions in health and social care is compassionate leadership and retention. There will be issues around ensuring that the funding goes into the right places. And there was also the point that was made earlier about training, specifically around perinatal things, but training will need to be more broad so that everyone has that experience that they can then fit in to perinatal pathways. One thing which I think is also important to mention at this point is thinking about, as well as capacity, which is what professionals do we have in Scotland, can they meet the demand, but is also to think about demands on services and whether there are alternative models, because we are seeing people coming forward with mental health difficulties, but also we have to operate with mental illness. And these things do sometimes synergize, but they can be quite separate. So someone having a mental health difficulty doesn't necessarily have a mental illness that might require secondary care or tertiary care when it comes to perinatal. So we do need to think about alternative models of providing people the help that they might need. So that might be peer support workers, it might be positioning people within primary care who might be able to meet the emerging needs as we emerge from the pandemic. But I think it's also around thinking about those wider issues, and that will then have a knock-on impact on secondary care and perinatal services too. Thank you.
And Dr. Gleder, we wanted to come in on your question, Gillian.
Thank you. The point I wish to highlight, I guess, as building on the earlier points, is that whilst recruitment has rapidly expanded over the past 18 months in services across Scotland, we do need to think about retention and staff wellbeing to kind of maintain and expand the services. In particular, we need national training pathways and numbers, but at the moment, we've really benefited from the work that NHS Education for Scotland has done and the perinatal curricular framework, that there's clear educational resources across the different professions and pathways, such as specialist services, but we do not yet have clear pathways that are discipline specific that highlight the numbers that we need to train to ensure that we have sufficient numbers that accounts for a drop off or loss or changes of careers. For example, in perinatal psychiatry, there's no national perinatal training numbers. And at the moment, we're very vulnerable to the other challenges in the mental health workforce, such as general adult psychiatry, which means that we could lose the gains that we've made. So there is a real need for national training pathways, regional training placements, so that the students of today can become the perinatal workforce of tomorrow. And at the moment, we do not have those training pathways for Scotland.
Yep. Stephanie, did you want to come in on this particular issue?
That would be great, thank you. I really wanted to ask about what impact workforce issues are having on patient care, and also on the ability of GPs, midwives, health visitors, etc., to actually work together effectively as a team. I know that some of the women that I spoke to last night felt as if, maybe people had all had a little bit of their jigsaw, but that wasn't necessarily coming together, so the whole picture was being seen, and they found it difficult to get help as a result. Thanks.
Would you like to direct that to anyone in particular, or my colleagues? Can I maybe come to Mary Ross-Davey initially on that, and then if anyone else wants to come in on the back of that, please use the chat function and I'll take you in turn. Mary.
Thank you. I'm sure all of you will be aware of what's been described as a crisis in maternity services currently across the UK, with the chronic shortages of midwives really becoming acute during the pandemic. That does then, of course, have a huge impact on the quality of care that midwives are able to provide. Because if you're a midwife who is really doing the job of two, then you need to cut your cloth accordingly in terms of the length of appointments. And particularly in relation to perinatal mental health, it's absolutely vital that you have time during an appointment to build up rapport, to spend time really getting to know that individual and to build that trust. An impact on the quality of care. I think it's in some respects the move to some virtual working and being able to have virtual multidisciplinary team meetings that has arisen through the pandemic has been of benefit. So I've heard where it's been much more possible during the pandemic to get together a meeting with all of the professionals and support people involved in a woman's care, so GP, health visitor, midwife, obstetrician, perinatal mental health team are able to get together on a virtual platform like this to have a planning meeting. So I think there are some silver linings that have made that kind of multidisciplinary working on occasion easier during the pandemic. But I think the pressures of time and the pressures of the shortages of staff are absolutely vital that those are addressed as a matter of urgency. I also do think that Dr. Chopra's point about the need to invest and support and work with voluntary sector organisations is vital, that it's clear that universal services like midwifery can't provide everything, that we need that investment in those other support areas as well, so that we can all work together really effectively to provide the right level of care. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to Dr. Gleder Ware and then I'll come to Professor Knight?
Thank you. I would agree that the pandemic has really affected women and their families significantly in terms of the support they've been able to receive. That's both been in terms of the informal support, antenatal groups, meeting other women, peer support, particularly voluntary sector support, you know, stopped quite abruptly at times, but is fortunately restarting. As Mary Ross Davies highlighted, there's also been interruptions in continuity of care. All women have not had as much face-to-face contact, as she highlighted, to develop that kind of trusting relationship to open up with those more maybe sensitive topics or particular areas of difficulty that women might be experiencing. In specialist services, they've adapted as much as possible to retain as much face-to-face contact and were often the only professionals at the start of the pandemic, aside of midwifery, that were seeing women regularly. Certainly, I think women have been challenged in how easy it is to see their GP and whether they're able to kind of make, you know, appointments to see them face to face. And there's certainly a lot of information that is lost through telephone consultations and, for example, in video consultations. It can be hard to fully assess the parent-infant relationship. So I think the pandemic has had a number of aspects on both the availability of support, both socially in the voluntary sector, as well as statutory and specialist services, but also how that support is delivered has varied. And I think that has particularly affected women's experiences and had a knock-on effect on their mental health. And anecdotally, I think that may be one of the contributing factors to women raising the concern about significant levels of birth trauma, because they've just not had that face-to-face continuity of care that's really would have helped buffered against kind of particular trauma during childbirth. So those are the particular vulnerabilities that our members have highlighted. Certainly, as Mary Ross Davey fed back, there have been some silver linings and teams have been nimble in how they've been communicating, and we've continued multidisciplinary and multi-agency kind of care coordination, and it's been easier to continue that with some professional groups than others. Thank you.
And can I come to Professor Knight?
Thank you. I just wanted to pick up on the role of the GP and actually thinking pre-pregnancy and what an important, what a substantial impact it can have to have all the planning around mental health care made before pregnancy. We haven't really talked about pre-pregnancy, but we see very clear examples where risk mitigation strategies have been discussed and planned for pre-pregnancy between GP and mental health services. And then that means that all actions can be put in place if women's mental health deteriorates during or immediately after pregnancy. And I think that the GP capacity in particular has been lost to be thinking about that, the preventive, the pre-pregnancy. And all too often we still see the structural biases in pregnancy care, such that women stop medication or are told to stop medication inappropriately. Nobody thinks about the impact that will have on their mental health. They're solely thinking about fetal risk. And really concerningly, nobody even thinks that they should restart medication post-pregnancy, even if they make it through pregnancy. And that for me is where the GP is a clear continuity, you know, clear linchpin in continuity, pre-pregnancy, during pregnancy, and particularly post-pregnancy.
Thank you. We are going to dig in further into training. Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, everybody. It's been really interesting hearing responses so far, and touched a wee bit to Dr. Chopra on training. I'm interested in, I suppose, looking at what training is available, what training is being delivered, and what the barriers are, if any. My understanding is that there is a Royal College of GP perinatal mental health toolkit. There's been information produced by NES, and all these e-learning modules, and I know that there's an Edinburgh postnatal depression scale that's used to assess women once they've delivered their baby. But there seems to be so much information out there, but how is it being delivered for health professionals, whether it's midwives or GPs or other practitioners?
That's Dr. Chopra.
Thank you. It's a bit of a shame that Selena had to leave at that point, because I'm sure she would have much to say around the perinatal curricula. I'm familiar with some of the training material that was mentioned there, but not all of it. What I would mention is that the NES perinatal mental health curriculum, which I've had a look at in the context of some other work that we did, is brilliant. It is actually really good training. It's pitched at various different levels to allow people to determine what sort of training they need at what level, and it builds gradually, which is exactly the sort of training that you need when you think about the earlier point that we were making around ensuring that training is available, not just to specialist perinatal mental health services, which I think is a point that the whole panel has echoed, but actually is available to general teams, to primary care, and to general mental health services, so that people understand the differing risk levels that operate at perinatal times and the need to refer to the specialist services and get people the support that they need. So I suppose that's the one of the key points around training that I'd like to make there.
And Mary wants to come in on that.
Yes, we've seen a huge increase in the amount of education that student midwives have in their degree, pre-registration degree, on perinatal mental health issues over the last 15 years. So from a time around 15 years ago when a student midwife might expect to only have about 3 hours of training on perinatal mental health, they will now expect to have whole modules focused on perinatal mental health needs, and perinatal mental health will be included and woven through the whole curriculum of the 3 years. But what we do have is a large number of midwives in the workforce who didn't have that sound grounding in their initial education and training around perinatal mental health. So there is still work to do to ensure that those midwives have a really sound our understanding of perinatal mental health. What is difficult when you have staff shortages is that that reduces the amount of time that midwives are given for continuing professional development. And what we see is that midwives are being expected to undertake continuing professional development in their own time. So that having ring-fenced time for education through your career is an absolutely vital element. I would also echo how brilliant the NHS Education for Scotland resources are. They've been developing over a number of years, and the curricular framework does address different needs for different groups, from those providing universal care right up to specialist perinatal mental health workers. So it's a really good system of support and education that's provided through NHS. But it is about enabling people to access that education in their work time, and to then, if they are providing that level of care, that they're offered support and supervision when they're providing care to women with significant perinatal mental health problems. That's really key to prevent burnout and also to ensure that the care being provided is high quality and evidence-based. But NHS has done a huge amount of work, and I'd say that Scotland is ahead on this in relation to the rest of the UK. Thanks.
I think what you've said, Mary, about education in work time is really, really important. I probably need to remind everybody I was a clinical educator before I was an MSP, and I did provide education to midwives and as well. But I think it is really important that we do offer education in work time. I suppose a comment around whether you think that providing education directly in the workplace and not expecting people to do continued professional development away from the workplace in their own time, that would also support retention and of the workforce as well, which you previously mentioned.
To Mary,
yes, please.
Thank you. Yes, we've certainly found models that use that work-based training. So we have the SMMDP service in Scotland that's run by NHS that provides clinical skills training for maternity teams that is done locally, but has a nationally accredited quality curriculum. We also see that with things like the prompt training, but they tend to all focus on those obstetric emergencies, which is absolutely vital that we have that continued training for maternity teams on how to deal with those obstetric emergencies, so postpartum hemorrhage, shoulder dystocia. But we should use that model for these other issues, such as perinatal mental health, substance misuse, supporting women where there are child protection and safeguarding concerns, that should be the model, and this should be part of the mandatory expected training for midwives and other maternity professionals and support workers. So what we need is a far greater number of clinical educators out in the service as yourself than we have currently, and a real focus on developing those roles across Scotland. Thank you.
Sandesh Gohani has a question.
Thank you, Kavina. Yes, it's just on what M. Harper's just said, but my question really is about ethnicity and what training is being given to ensure that the differences in ethnicity are being picked up and are being assessed and are being treated, where previously, certainly as a doctor being trained in the 2000s, that's not something that I received.
Do you want to direct that to anyone in
probably
particular?
Probably to Dr. Chopra and maybe Mary.
Dr. Chopra.
Thank you. Yes. MSPs, members of the committee may be aware that the Commission actually published a report on racial inequality and mental health in October of this year. So it's a wide-ranging report that looks at racial differences in accessing mental health care, in the way that people are experience the use of the Mental Health Act. It also talks about the lived experience of people coming from ethnic backgrounds and their experience of mental health services, differences in representation from people in the workforce in mental health and how they progress within mental health services, and also talks about training. There's a whole chapter where we focus on what training is available to people around what we've called cultural competence. And what we've found is that the majority of training is done through what's called LearnPro, which is an e-module that people are expected to complete. And what 70% of staff who responded to our survey on training around ethnicity and mental health, it wasn't specific to perinatal, it was ethnicity and mental health, is that they found it didn't meet the needs. And that's because the goalposts have changed in 2021. People are much more experienced and understand a lot more about how ethnicity and race impacts on healthcare. And what's currently being delivered through Scotland, through most health boards, and we did focus on health boards in this area, is a module which was considered to be inadequate to meet the needs. So we've made recommendations around that to Scottish Government to consider asking NES to provide modules which are more bespoke. We've spoken about the needs of asylum seekers and refugees, and particular kind of modules that focused on primary care as well as secondary care to meet their needs, so that they don't get re-traumatized by having to tell their story several times. So there's a kind of a lot of work that the Commission has undertaken around racial inequality and mental health, and be very happy to send the committee a link to that report and address any questions that arise from that. On perinatal specifically, I must say again, we're going back to the NES module. The NES curriculum for perinatal mental health does contain a section about culture and meeting the needs of people who are coming from different cultures and different ethnicities, and it's brilliant, because it shows at various different levels what sort of competencies you might want to achieve to be able to meet someone's needs. So at the most basic level, it may be an understanding of someone's background. The level above might be about the use of advocacy and the use of interpreters. And there's a whole kind of specialism about how you use interpreters well. The level above that might be about understanding the power dynamics that take place in a clinical interaction when people are coming from different backgrounds. And it develops accordingly. But yes, I welcome the question, and I think there's a lot of work that we need to do as we, you know, build back fairer and create a more equitable access to all parts of services.
Thank you. We definitely would like to see that report, because it will inform our wider work on mental health. So thank you for offering it. Can I come to Gillian Mackay, who wants to come in on the training issue? Gillian.
Thank you, Convener. When a woman is pregnant or has recently given birth, she will be in contact with a range of health professionals, potentially creating lots of opportunities to identify if she's struggling. Is the panel confident that staff have the training to take up these opportunities? For example, do you think primary care teams in particular are equipped to identify perinatal mental health issues? And could I come to Mary Ross Davey for that first?
I think, as we've discussed earlier, there are real opportunities in Scotland in relation to some of the resources that we now have that are suitable for primary care, for midwifery and other health professionals, in terms of raising awareness about perinatal mental health. I think the issues that I have rehearsed today are that people need the time to do it, and that we need enough staff to do this effectively. And we need to have systems of care that enable health professionals to build those relationships. So no, at the moment, we don't have all of that in place. And we don't have the staffing or the opportunities for education or support or the systems of care that really enable us to maximise what we want to be able to do in terms of identifying those women who are struggling and then being able to offer them really adequate support. Because what feels really difficult for midwives, health visitors, GPs, is if a woman does disclose that she is struggling through something like the Edinburgh postnatal depression scale that was mentioned earlier and the conversations around that, if you are then not able to get them the support that they need. So they've disclosed to you, you know there's a problem, but you don't have anywhere to be able to refer them to where they're going to be able to be seen quickly and get the support they need. So often midwives and health visitors feel that they can be left holding someone's care needs and support when actually they're needing more specialist support. I'd also, if it's possible, just like to come back to the previous question in terms of ethnicity and the impacts on maternity outcomes. Professor Knight will be able to talk about this very eloquently, but we do know from the Embrace reports that Black women are four times as likely to die in childbirth or postnatally. So there are huge inequities in terms of the outcomes from maternity services for women from ethnic minorities. This is something that we are seeking to address from the RCM perspective in terms of providing much more focused education and training for student midwives and midwives about the issues of racial disparities and their impacts in maternity care and in perinatal mental health care. But there's much to be done, and there's much to be done in Scotland. We know from recent reports that ethnicity isn't being adequately recorded in the antenatal period. So we're not able to identify what those disparities are in Scotland adequately. So we need to improve that recording, the conversations that are being had, and the confidence of health professionals in talking about race and ethnicity and addressing their own unconscious bias. There's a huge training need across Scotland in relation to this. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I bring in Professor Knight?
Thank you. I wanted to pick up on the previous point, and I think it's really important that we recognise actually how complex to a service user the whole system around maternity care is, and very much the pattern we see amongst the women who die by suicide is that they have had multiple contacts with different individuals. So they might have seen the GP on one occasion, emergency department on another occasion, health visitor on another occasion, with concerning symptoms which have been either normalised or dismissed, and nobody has recognised the overall pattern. So for me, the phrase is it only takes one person, but there does need to be that one person who knows an individual well enough to be able to recognise that deteriorating pattern of symptoms, whether it's the GP, whether it's the midwife. We've seen fantastic examples of health visitors who have been the linchpin in ensuring women get the care they need. But it is ensuring that there is that one person, and just picking up on the ethnicity issue. When we look particularly at what is affecting the care of Black women who die, it is that individualised care, that recognition of the cultural nuance and the recognition of the woman as an individual to make sure that she gets the care she needs, and the recognition that there is no one size fits all. If I was going to summarise the main message for me in terms of perinatal mental health pathways, there will never be one solution that is right for every woman. We have to make sure that whatever an individual woman's needs, she is able to negotiate those pieces of the pathway, and that her symptoms are not normalised by every person she meets as she goes along.
Thank you. And Dr. Chopra.
Thank you. I wanted to reiterate a point that we made right at the beginning of this session, which I think will be helpful in response to that question. And that's about clear, explicit pathways, which is one of the things which the Embrace report speaks to. And notwithstanding the need for nuance and the need to kind of individualize it, I think one thing that would help everyone is to have very clear, explicit pathways into perinatal mental health services at all different levels. And I think that mitigates some of the uncertainty. It allows universalism, it still allows for nuance, but I think it'd be great if every health board had very clear, explicit pathways all the way from primary care into secondary care, into perinatal care, and also to mother and baby units, which is one of the points that we made in our evidence around service level agreements, so that there isn't any sort of questioning or misunderstanding when someone needs specialist care in an inpatient facility as to where they need to go, what might be the right pathway for them. Yes, there should be ability to be patient-centred and have nuance, but clear, explicit pathways going right back to the beginning, I think, would make a huge difference.
Thank you. We're rapidly running out of time. I do want to address some of the issues that have come up as a result of COVID-19, because we had a substantial amount of testimony from mothers and fathers around that. Carol Mochen, can I come to you?
Convener, morning to the panel. Yes, as the convener said last night, we had a number of people with lived experience, and what was very striking is that we're all affected and talk about the effects of COVID-19, but it did seem that for the women in this category and the fathers in this category, that there were some major things that we need to address for those people now and going forward. And I just wondered if the panel had any advice they could give us on the return to services, which seem very different across Scotland, and also anything that might need to be put in place to support these people as we go forward in the next year or so.
Will we address that to Marion at night, first of all? I think one of the things as well we found last night is that the impact of not having partners to be able to be with them at antenatal classes and throughout the pregnancy was during the birth was quite acute. Marion Knight.
So I was just going to reflect on what we saw, particularly in the initial phase of the pandemic, where face-to-face services and indeed mental health services were not recognised to have the priority they needed. And we had women whose appointments were cancelled because of the pandemic. Subsequently, 2 months later, letters were sent giving them leaflets of advice. Again, the thresholds being imposed such that the letter that I vividly remember was that it said, we don't care for women who are not acutely mentally ill, despite the fact that this woman had known long-term mental health problems. And sadly, she took her life 2 weeks later. And there didn't seem to be a recognition that you can't do everything remotely. There needs to be a triage system, even if we're continuing with some remote consultations. We have to recognise that, particularly with mental health, there will be a need for ongoing face-to-face services, and I think we have to ensure that mental health services are prioritised for that return to face-to-face consultation. And it's not assumed that it can all be done remotely. So for me, that is the most important thing. Family support, as you've highlighted, is crucial for women who've got mental health problems and who need advocates because of their complex background. So ensuring that those the ability of others to be with them is also going to be really important.
Thank you. And Mary wanted to come in.
Thank you. I'm really pleased to hear that you've heard the direct testimonies of women and families of their experiences of giving birth during the pandemic. We too have heard extremely distressing stories from women who've given birth during the pandemic in terms of their sense of isolation, of loneliness, of difficulties in accessing care from health professionals, but also those more informal sources of support that come from antenatal support groups, antenatal classes, postnatal support groups. I think in the past, those elements of maternity provision have been under-supported, under-appreciated, have maybe been seen as a nice to do, nice to have. When there are midwifery shortages and pressures in the service, we see antenatal classes being one of the first things to go and being pulled back from. So I think if there's one key lesson that we can have from the pandemic, it's that these support classes and education classes, antenatally and postnatally, aren't just nice to have. They're an absolutely key part of the provision of decent supportive services during the perinatal period. What we have been able to do during the pandemic is rapidly instigate more virtual appointments. So through the Near Me programme, being able to provide virtual antenatal clinic appointments. And that is, there have been positive elements to that, but it's really key that we don't become reliant on those virtual appointments, because as was mentioned earlier, it's very difficult for health professionals to pick up on some of the non-verbal cues and nuance in virtual appointments. And if someone is not wanting to open up and give things away, it's much more difficult to kind of get beneath that veneer in a virtual appointment, not least because as many women don't have access to good Wi-Fi like we're experiencing today and good data availability. So often it will revert to a crackly mobile phone consultation where you're not going to pick up on those issues. I think also, as was mentioned earlier, being able to pick up on that relationship between the mother and baby in those early days postnatally. Postnatal care, postpartum care has often been described as the Cinderella element of maternity services. It's so important that you have skilled midwives going in really regularly to the home in those first days after the birth, and then that is carried on by health visitors to really support the development of that relationship and really pick up on how the woman is. You can't be just popping in and out or just having the odd telephone call. So again, postnatal, postpartum services are absolutely vital. They're not just a nice to have. So those need investment again, and they need adequate staffing to provide. In terms of the role of partners, I think that's been hugely distressing for women because it has become the norm in maternity services over the last several years that partners are there at every scan, every antenatal appointment, throughout an induction process, throughout labour and birth, and then on the postnatal ward. We've had really open visiting in maternity services for many years now, and that has become an expectation. What I would say is that maternity services focused very hard on during all parts of the pandemic on making sure that partners were able to be there during active labour and birth, and that was always there. But that did mean that there were some women who had longer induction process and were on the antenatal ward who didn't have their partners with them at all times, and also women who were attending scans where they perhaps received bad news where their partners weren't with them. So again, I think we've been able to really recognise that partners are part of the care team, that maternity services should be seeing the family as who we're providing care for, and that's will hopefully bring those changes and ensure that we return as rapidly as we can to having partners throughout the journey. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I come finally to Dr. Chopra?
Thank you. I would echo the points that the previous two panellists have made. The Commission, in its intelligence gathering, has heard very clearly about the isolation that people have experienced during the pandemic. In a practical sense, we've also heard about the difficulties it's had in terms of discharge planning from mother and baby units and leave. Because of the impacts of, you know, potentially getting the virus and then coming back, it means that it's more difficult to organise leave. And I was pleased to hear the emphasis on partners, including fathers, because they've experienced that same sense of isolation too. Having said all that, I think there is an opportunity now to think about how we adapt to this new normal. The idea that we're going to go back to some sort of old normal increasingly seems distant to me. I think we may experience further variants, further disruption, but I think what we ought to be thinking about is how do we build back fairer and how do we adapt our system. And I think in terms of those virtual appointments, I think there's the opportunity to really build choice into the system. So rather than one size fits all, that it's either face to face or it's virtual, actually, wherever possible, giving people that choice as to how would they want to accept aspects of their care that could be delivered in different platforms. So I think it's the centrality of choice that I'd like to emphasise. And that's perhaps the opportunity that this difficult period that we've lived through does now provide us.
Thank you. We have run out of time in this session. We could go on for easily another hour. But what you have told us has been hugely helpful, hugely valuable, and we thank you very much for your time this morning. We're going to take a short break while we allow our other panel to come in and come back at 11:15. Thank you. Welcome back, everyone. We continue item two of our agenda now with a second evidence session with stakeholders as part of our inquiry into perinatal mental health. And we've got a second panel joining us. And good morning, everyone. A welcome to Kat Berry, the group facilitator and volunteer coordinator for the Juno Perinatal Mental Health Support. We've got Joanne Smith, the chair of Maternal Mental Health Scotland. Fiona Chalicum, the patron of maternal OCD, and Clea Harmer, the chief executive of SANS. Welcome to you all. I guess I'd like, again, going round the panel, person by person, my opening question to you all about the role that your group plays in supporting women and their families in the perinatal period. We've heard from our clinicians and our academics, and they have referenced the third sector many times, and if you were watching the panel before. So if I come to each of you, can I come to Kat Berry first of all?
Hello, hi. I'm Kat Berry from Juno. We're a purely voluntary-led organisation, and we run support groups for women in the perinatal period. So anything from conception up until when their child is about 2 years old. We run kind of general support groups online and face-to-face. Obviously the face-to-face groups were not able to run during the pandemic, and we kind of had to, come up with an online solution. And because the online solution has worked quite well, we've continued that, and we've also brought a face-to-face group back as well. We're purposefully unfunded. The reason being that we realise that funding can be given and it can also be taken away as well. And the fact is, we don't want to be dependent on funding and then for it to be taken away, because women in the perinatal mental health, or in the perinatal period, need support full stop, permanently. And so we have to, you know, we've had to find a way to survive. Whatever government we have, whatever their policies are, we're keeping going. We have two types of support group. We have our general support groups, which are for anything like prenatal anxiety, postnatal anxiety, postnatal depression. We cover OCD, although it's less common in our groups. We also have a birth trauma group, which unfortunately we haven't been able to bring back post-pandemic. We desperately want to, but we our general group is facilitated by trained peer support facilitators, whereas our birth trauma group is facilitated by professionals who are not just trauma informed, but trauma skilled, and it's slightly different structure. The reason why we have those two separate groups is because after running groups since 2015, we realised that if you had a woman with prenatal anxiety and a woman with postnatal PTSD in the same room, it's not a good match, and both women will need to be supported in a very different way separately. So I guess there's three themes which we have identified pre and post pandemic. And these things were, they existed pre-pandemic, but they've really been exacerbated by the pandemic. So the first one being isolation. And that has really, really been exacerbated during the pandemic, particularly as not only the shortage of NHS services and also third sector services, but also in terms of friends and family weren't allowed to visit in the full lockdown. And you know how it is with a small baby. You need as much help as you can get, and it just wasn't there. And we had a lot of women very, very, very isolated. Secondly, the second theme which has really come up is birth trauma, a massive rise in that pre-pandemic, but that has been really exacerbated during the pandemic with, again, less support has led to more PTSD. And thirdly, lack of support, which has been exacerbated during the pandemic as well. So I'll go into those in more detail later on, but those are the three themes that really we've identified.
That's very helpful, and my colleagues will probably come back to quite a few of the things that you've brought up. Can I come to Joanne Smith?
Hi everyone, my name is Joanne Smith. I'm the chair of Maternal Mental Health Scotland. We are a coalition of statutory services, third sector services, and also women with lived experience of perinatal mental illness. Our role is to come together to provide a kind of strong collective voice to campaign for prioritisation and increased investment in perinatal and infant mental health services. We're entirely voluntary run, and we have kind of evolved over a decade from essentially a professional group, a clinical forum, into quite a significant kind of lobby operation, but it's sort of done entirely by volunteers. And I hope that we offer a kind of distinct overview of some of the kind of intertwined issues facing both statutory services, the third sector, and also peer support groups. Our aim is to create continuum pathways of support for families, running from family support through to specialist care. And that's obviously massively ambitious, but we believe that that's the kind of right ambition to have, and we've got strong foundations to build on in Scotland.
Thank you. And can I come to Fiona Chellicombe?
Hello, morning. I am here representing the charity Maternal OCD, which has been set up by two women with lived experience of maternal OCD in order to raise awareness of this very common condition. I myself am a clinical academic at King's College London, and I'm lucky enough to be patron of this charity. And we've been working over the last kind of 10 years to really, yeah, raise awareness amongst women and professionals. So the key sort of barriers really are that it's gone from a sort of lesser known condition, but the research is really showing us that actually it's a very common presentation in pregnancy, and particularly in the postnatal period. And it's kind of characterised by intrusive thoughts of harm coming to the infant, and sometimes horrible intrusive thoughts of deliberately harming the baby, which obviously is very distressing for women and can be misunderstood. So getting a good understanding of this quite common condition that can present across all aspects of the perinatal pathway in primary care, right up to kind of MBU, specialist care kind of level, is really important. So Maternal OCD has done a wonderful job in assisting with developing trainings for professionals, disseminating information to kind of GPs, people who might be the first point of contact for women with this very horrible disorder, and have facilitated peer support groups alongside a national charity, OCD Action, who continues those specialist groups for women, and have done so kind of through the pandemic. So that's been the main role.
Before I move on to a colleague, Fiona, can I ask you, maternal OCD, is it the case that because of the nature of it, that that's almost a barrier to women actually seeking support for own mental health, because they're worried about the consequences of admitting some of the challenges that they have in those intrusive thoughts?
Yes, Yes, absolutely. All mental health, perinatal mental health issues carry a stigma with disclosure, but it's quite clear that obviously there's an additional issue of potential misunderstanding, inappropriate risk assessments, and sometimes kind of very inappropriate treatments. So educating professionals about the right questions to ask to really ascertain whether this is OCD or perhaps another problem is really crucial, and of course has a huge potentially preventative function. And the other kind of issue is that we do have treatments that work very well for this condition. So disseminating that information, there's obviously been a lot so far about workforce training, but it's really key, I think, in a message to women that there is help that's very effective and should be available to all women.
Thank you for clarifying that. And finally, to Clea Harmer from SANS. Clea.
Hello, yes. So SANS offers support to anybody who's been affected by the death of a baby, and that's pregnancy loss and baby death. And I just want to start by thanking the committee for recognising the fact that bereaved parents do have specific and different needs, because in the past they have often been overlooked. So it's wonderful that you are recognising this within this space. So we offer support to parents through a range of channels, including group support, which face-to-face or via Zoom across Scotland, and we have special Scotland groups. But increasingly, we're offering support digitally, so online community, Facebook pages, but also through Instagram Messenger, people reaching out to us in lots of different ways. So I think it's really important to recognise that not only different channels work for people, but also that different levels of support are needed. And whilst we provide support ourselves and we provide a level of counselling, we know that many parents go on to experience quite severe mental health issues, such as PTSD and depression, complex grief. And we don't support those levels which need specialist psychological or psychiatric help. And I think that is a gap that it would be interesting to discuss further, because I think it's important that parents can access the support that they need. We also work with healthcare professionals to provide the training and the resources that they need to provide bereavement care. And that has been quite challenging during the pandemic over the last couple of years, but incredibly important that in those first days and hours after the death of a baby, parents are supported, often by midwives, but it can be by a whole range of professionals, and that those professionals also get the support that they need. So yes, in a nutshell, that's what we do.
Thank you. And my colleagues will be wanting to ask you all a range of questions. I just want to remind my colleagues and just make them aware that Fiona does have to leave at 11:30. So if there's particular questions around OCD, then you've got a window of half an hour to ask Fiona. But if there's anything obviously that we want to ask specifically that we don't get to, we can always get in touch with Fiona after this meeting. Can I move on to my colleague Stephanie Callaghan?
Thanks very much, convener, and thank you to the panel for coming along today. My question's for Joanne. You've spoken about the fact that you cover third sector as well as statutory services as well there. And I'm really interested as well in the evidence that we got from women about the importance of the role of the third sector. They spoke about Home Start and peer support there. And sometimes with health professionals, there was that worry, like Gillian kind of picked up earlier there, about maybe being too honest and too upfront and what the consequences of that could be. There was really very real fears about either the mum being taken away from their baby or the baby being taken away from their mum. So they felt very much like the peer support kind of gave a bit of trust on either side of it there, that they felt much more comfortable being open there. And I know from my own experience providing breastfeeding support as a volunteer peer support, that the midwife who led that said, that mum spoke to her very differently in her midwife role
from they did when she was doing peer support there. So what I'm wondering is, as far as the third sector's concerned, are they picking up services that really the NHS board should be delivering, or is there, you know, where does the balance of that lie? And also, what can our NHS boards actually learn from third sector organisations? Thanks, Joanne.
Thank you, Stephanie. Yes, I think that's a really kind of critical point. Organisations, you mentioned Homestart, but also Aberlour, Crossreach, they've been providing perinatal mental health support in communities for decades, probably before we were referring to it in those terms. So they bring a huge amount of specialism and expertise. And there is no question that their position within communities means that they are alongside families and able to identify risk early and intervene appropriately, often prevent problems escalating and therefore stripping out the demand for specialist services. They play an absolutely critical role, and very often our specialist services take a very kind of clinical view of social and emotional well-being, and people don't necessarily identify with some of the kind of clinical terminology that's used within specialist services. So I do think that having those local third sector services available means that women can overcome some of the kind of really pressing barriers that are to them disclosing that they may be struggling during this really kind of critical life stage. So the role of the third sector is absolutely critical. The Delivering Effective Services report carried out by the Managed Clinical Network concluded that short-termism in funding for third sector services had meant that well-established community services were sometimes unable to be sustained, and therefore we are losing some local specialism and expertise because of the short-term funding structures. That's obviously hugely problematic in terms of increasing demand for crisis services further down the line. And I think it's probably worth saying, Stephanie, that we agree with the approach to prioritise investment in specialist services. I understand that's the right thing to do. But of the kind of £50 million invested by the Perinatal and Intermental Health Programme Board, only £2.3 million was earmarked for the third sector. There was 95 applications for that fund, and only 16 organisations were successful in securing funding. So it indicates that there is a willingness there within the third sector to provide this local support. If we can get it right, then we are going to drive a shift towards prevention that we've long aspired to in Scotland, but currently national investment isn't sufficient to kind of provide that sustainable long-term third sector offer. So yeah, I think you're absolutely right. We can't understate the role of the third sector, and it's really critical that we kind of recognise and respect their role in that kind of spectrum of support that women need, that runs from that kind of low, moderate need up right up to specialist care.
Okay. Sandesh Gohani has a question. Oh, can I stop you there? Because I've just realised that Kat Berry has put in a request to speak in the chat box. So Sandesh, can you hang on a second? I'll come to Kat first, then I'll come to you. Kat.
Thank you. Yes, in terms of the third sector working with the NHS, a lot of work has been done recently by the Lothian Perinatal Collaborative to kind of join up those third sector organisations, particularly Juno, Crossreach and Homestart and Dad's Rock and Fathers Network Scotland and a few of the others, and kind of communicate and actually work with the NHS to kind of enable those mums and families who are currently falling through the net in terms of services to, you know, to, well, if we have a more joined up approach, then those people won't fall through the net quite so much. What we have been noticing, though, since pre-pandemic is the women that we're seeing at Juno, they're on very, very, very long NHS waiting lists, not just for CBT or EMDR, like through the NHS, but also for other third sector organisations who provide counselling. You know, at the moment, it's about a 4 or 5 month waiting list for the third sector organisations for one-to-one support. And for NHS, obviously, it's much longer. It's kind of up to a year at the moment. We try not to have a waiting list, and we're able to see people when they come to us. But it is it's a difficult, you know, it's. I know that some work is being done at the moment by various NHS departments to recruit more psychologists and counsellors, which hopefully should kind of plug that gap and kind of enable the waiting list to be not quite so long. But it is a real problem at the moment. And the thing is, the more that we can see people at the time when they need it, rather than kind of making them wait and wait and wait till their conditions get worse, it's best to kind of get it early, because then it's so much treatable. It's so much more treatable if we get them early rather than the conditions getting worse. The other thing I'd say is our birth trauma group model. It's been used by the Make Birth Better campaign as a model for best practice, and it's in the Make Birth Better handbook, which midwives are currently using in the NHS. And we are kind of trying to join up a bit more with the NHS to try and enable for that model to be brought into the NHS. But of course, that needs funding as well.
Thank you. I can now hand over to Sandesh Gulhani. Sandesh.
Works quite well, because my question's for Kat Berry. You talked about birth trauma, and we went through a very difficult birth of my first child, and the support really wasn't there. And my question really to you is, whilst we all recognise it's the woman that goes through the birth trauma, the men associated, the partners associated, I associated, also suffered trauma through it, and was wondering what support is in place, not only from yourself, but from perhaps other health boards when it comes to the partners of the women going through the birth trauma.
That's a really, really important key question, because what is not really talked about or recognised is that birth trauma can happen to partners and dads as well. And there is something about the person that you love most going through something absolutely horrific, and as a partner you have no control over it and no way to help them. And that is very, very traumatic. The thing that's really important to say is it's possible to have a traumatic birth, but it not lead to PTSD if the right support is in place. However, it's possible to have a kind of textbook, totally normal birth, and for it to lead to PTSD in both mother and father or partner, but it does lead to PTSD if there isn't the right support in place. What's really, really crucial is PTSD is preventable in these circumstances with the right support. At the moment, there is not the right support in place, and that is why we're seeing a rise in PTSD. I know that Dads Rock at the moment, which is a third sector organisation, they are looking at providing, well, they already provide groups for dads anyway, They have been looking at providing groups for birth trauma, but obviously it's a question of these birth trauma groups. It's not they're not straightforward peer support, which is what Juno and Dad's Rock are able to provide. It requires professionals to facilitate these birth trauma groups. At the moment, the NHS provision for birth trauma is, there's nothing specifically for birth trauma, to treat birth trauma. I know that a lot of work is being done behind the scenes by Kirsten Kuhl and Melanie Martin to kind of create a structure. I know that money has been put in to create more provision for trauma skilled workers who are able to give people treatment on the NHS, one-to-one services, but also groups. But obviously that takes time. And from, you know, the perspective of parents who are experiencing both trauma and PTSD now, it's not coming soon enough.
Can I
hope that answers your question.
Can I come to Paul O'Kane has a question, Paul?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. My question really is, I think we've heard quite a bit about the work that's done and the huge support I think the third sector provides. So I'm keen to just understand thoughts on the sustainability of third sector organisations. Obviously, we've had the Perinatal and Infant Mental Health Fund launched in May of 2020, and obviously £665,000 to support 16 organisations. I mean, is that fund providing the sort of sustainability that's needed, or do we need to go further and find other ways of kind of mainlining that funding, I guess? And I suppose I'd maybe direct that to Claire and to Kat, if possible, if we've got time.
Okay, so we go to Claire first.
Hi, thank you. Yes, I mean, I think that undoubtedly the funding is really appreciated and helpful for the third sector. But I think if it's actually going to be part of, if the third sector is going to be an acknowledged part of referral pathways, and certainly talking about bereaved parents, the National Bereavement Care Pathway, which is funded by the Scottish Government and which we lead on, that the bit within the hospitals is funded really well. But what midwives, obstetricians, neonatologists find when they try and refer people back into the community is that that's where things start going wrong, because the funding hasn't established the structure in the community. So I would say that if it could be more formalised, as it now is in, it's certainly for the bereavement care pathway within the hospital, if a similar structure could exist in the community, it would prevent parents and families from falling through the gaps. Because at the moment, it's incredibly difficult to provide enough support and services for everybody. And obviously, you know, the challenges within Scotland, geographical and the diversity of the groups that we're trying to reach and their different needs, means that it is a struggle to be there in every part of Scotland for everybody. And I do think a commitment to funding that allowed the third sector to provide a safe and secure structure everywhere would be a good thing for parents.
Can I come to Joanne?
Hi, thanks for your question. That's really helpful. I think that the kind of priority in investment in perinatal mental health has been hugely beneficial to third sector organisations. But I think it's worth saying what we're trying to achieve is a really ambitious culture shift. You know, it's a huge task. It requires kind of investment and expansion in the workforce across all tiers of health and the third sector. I suppose we need to start where we can have the biggest impact. And the third sector fund, it's a one-off fund. And I don't think that one-off funds can deliver that culture shift that's required to move practice and to integrate services towards prevention. The Scottish Government has, however, committed £500 million wellbeing family fund, and that's an advance, but again, it is one-off, it's not recurring. I think what is an interesting advance is the commitment within the programme government to redirect 5% of the community health and social care budget towards preventative services. That could be an interesting approach to actually embedding support for third sector services into kind of universal funding streams to make them much more kind of secure and to begin to build that integrated kind of health and social care partnership that we've long aspired to in Scotland. But the fund in its current form, it's not sufficient, and especially coming off the back of the pandemic when needs increased significantly.
Thank you. And Kat Berry wants to come in. Kat.
Thank you. Yeah, I would absolutely agree with Joanne that prevention is really important as well, particularly with regards to birth trauma. When it comes to third sector organisations being a kind of support to the NHS when it comes to treating particularly birth trauma, unfortunately around Scotland, third sector organisations who deal with birth trauma are very patchy, and really it's something that the NHS should be providing. Obviously we have a model which we can show to the, we can work with the NHS to ensure that that model is followed, this tried and tested model. However, it is something, you know, in this case that the NHS should be providing. Also, when it comes to prevention of birth trauma, one of my colleagues, Dr. Jenny Patterson, wrote a paper called Traumatised Midwives, Traumatised Women in 2019. And really, she found that the biggest cause of PTSD in birthing women was a lack of care from midwives, because midwives are so stretched at the moment, and that's only got worse during the pandemic. We've seen, you know, we saw the March for Midwives last month, you know, and these awful stories about midwives not being able to look after them, their own basic human needs. They don't have time to go to the loo, they don't have time to have their lunch break, they're working other people's shifts, there's just not enough staff. You know, if these midwives are looking after their, you know, they can't even look after their own needs, how are they meant to be looking after the needs of birthing people? And that is what is leading to a lot of PTSD, because the adequate support needed for birthing people is not in place at the moment. It's not in place at the moment.
Thank you very much. I'm delving in more to the support for at-risk and vulnerable women. Emma Harper.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming today. In the submission from the Mental Health Foundation, they recommended that the development of perinatal mental health services be equality-proofed in order to reduce the social inequalities that may prevent pregnant and postnatal women from experiencing good mental health. So I'm interested in your thoughts on what the gaps are and in the delivery of perinatal mental health, especially in relation to at-risk or vulnerable women.
As with all these questions, if anybody wants to start off, just raise your hand, and if you want to come in, use the chat box on the platform that you're on. But if anyone wants to start off there, let me know. I'll maybe go to Kat.
Oh, I think Joanne might have been before me.
Okay, I'll go to Joanne then. Joanne.
Hi there. Thanks for that question. That's a really important point. And I think it's an area that we don't really understand enough about, and we've heard from others today about you know, that we're not sufficiently disaggregating data about who's accessing our specialist services. So we don't really know how inclusive they are or accessible they are, so we do need to get better at that. We, in my kind of full-time role with NSPCC Scotland, we did a needs assessment, an infant mental health needs assessment in NHS Lanarkshire. And it had interesting findings. It showed that the women accessing specialist perinatal mental health services, those in areas with the fewest number of vulnerable pregnancies, there was the highest number of successful referrals to specialist services. And conversely, in areas where there was the highest number of vulnerable pregnancies, there was the fewest successful referrals to specialist services. So it's a really complex picture, but what it indicates, I think, is that an inverse care law is at play in perinatal mental health services, and that in some ways it may be the case that social class or race could undermine a woman's ability to access specialist support. Now, I'm sure there's a range of reasons for that, but we wonder about medical professionals and about a woman's ability to describe her difficulties in a way that resonates with the medical professional, and whether that increases the likelihood that that woman will be able to access specialist support. And I raise that because it's a complex area, but I think that we are guilty as professionals of assuming that if a woman is experiencing mental health difficulties alongside other adversities, such as, you know, substance misuse or material deprivation, then it can be easier for us to assume that if we remove those wider adversities, then we address the mental health issues. And of course, in many cases, that is true. But it is also true that women who are experiencing disadvantage can have long-standing mental health difficulties that are further exacerbated by the arrival of a new baby. And those women deserve the right to access specialist mental health care. And in many cases, they're not receiving it because their mental health difficulties coexist alongside other adversities. So I do think there's an issue around the accessibility of their specialist services, who's able to access specialist support and why they're able to access it. And I think it's an area that warrants more research to help us understand what the kind of local picture is in Scotland.
Okay, I'll come to Kat next.
Thank you. There are two categories, I suppose, of at-risk and vulnerable women, which at the moment we see are being missed. The first being women with a history of rape and sexual abuse, and particularly because they may not be, you know, when the midwife asks the question, the birthing woman may not feel comfortable disclosing her sexual history in front of her partner or husband. We do see women who go through childbirth, and to them, you know, childbirth should be this kind of wonderful, joyful occasion, you know, bringing new life into the world, whereas actually the sensation of giving birth gives them flashbacks to the rape that they had previously, particularly in terms of the cervix being absolutely pummeled during childbirth, and also, well, I won't go into it because it's really, really distressing, but it's an area which at the moment is not being addressed, and it's really, really important. And whether there could be some way of introducing a protocol for midwives to ask these questions kind of separately from the partner, so that they're prepared for that and they can give them adequate support, particularly when it comes to invasive
examinations and informed consent is really, really important because women who have had rape or sexual abuse in the past may be re-triggered again by invasive examinations that, you know, by staff who are not giving adequate informed consent for why they're performing these examinations, et cetera, et cetera. The other group of parents is parents who are going through miscarriage or stillbirth. I know it's been publicised a little bit in the news, and the Scottish Government has promised to introduce specialist baby loss units for people, for parents who are going through miscarriage and stillbirth. But in reality, the NHS says that they're not going to be implemented till 2024. And just being really, really, really clear about this, at the moment, the reality is parents who are going to hospital, they know they're going to have a stillbirth or they're going through miscarriage. At the moment, they are told beforehand that they're going to press the buzzer of the door and they'll be greeted by a specialist bereavement midwife. That's not happening. It's not happening. The reality is they're pressing the buzzer on the door. It's the maternity ward. It's the normal maternity ward. And they're being greeted at the door by, you know, happy fathers with balloons saying, congratulations, welcome to the world. And they're having to kind of run a gauntlet of like balloons and teddies and all these things saying, congratulations. And It's not fair. it's really inhumane, actually, that these parents who are already going through the trauma of losing a baby are having to go through that added trauma. It's like adding salt to the wound. You know, having to go through a stillbirth or a miscarriage in a ward next door to parents who are giving birth to perfectly healthy babies. It shouldn't be happening, and it's just really, really easily solvable. I don't know why it's taking until 2024 to solve this problem, because it could be solved much earlier than that. So it's something that I would flag up to the Scottish Government. Please implement them earlier before more people have to suffer.
Kat, Sandesh wants to pick up on that point that you've just made. Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener, for taking me. I did my training at the Glasgow Royal Infirmary, and they, when I was in the maternity obstetric unit, they actually have a separate area for mothers that are going to be experiencing this exact problem for stillbirth and not seeing the happiness that other people have. And it is very much a closed unit. And I was wondering if you feel that was an appropriate thing that we could maybe roll out to have that separate unit a little bit further away from the main ward.
Kat?
Yes, absolutely. Dedicated baby loss units are vital, and parents who are going through the process of losing a baby should not have to be going through that in the same wards as parents who are going through, you know, normal, healthy childbirth. Yes, I think there needs to be a separate entrance for a start. But yes, a separate unit completely for a separate baby loss unit for parents who are going through miscarriage and stillbirth. I'm sure Sands will have an opinion on the subject as well.
Yeah, I'm going to come to Claire now. Claire.
Thank you. Yes, and absolutely. I mean, I think Kat's described beautifully the issues. I think I would say that this is what the National Bereavement Care Pathway is. And the idea was that National Bereavement Care Pathway would be rolled out in Scotland, and it coincided with the start of the pandemic. So some hospitals already do have both bereavement suites and separate areas. And the idea is that will be rolled out across the whole of Scotland. I think one of the problems has been during the pandemic, a lot of the rooms were redeployed and had to be used in different ways. And it has been very frustrating to see that this hasn't been prioritised and put back on track, because it makes an enormous difference to parents. Obviously, to not only have the space to give birth, but also then to have the space to be with their baby and make memories and take the time that they need afterwards. And again, that was very difficult during the pandemic, and the compassionate care was difficult because everyone was wearing PPE. So I think a lot of things, you know, good intentions and plans were put on hold. And I do think it's really important that they're prioritised as part of the kind of getting back to normal again, rather than kind of seen as, you know, nice to have and extras. And the other thing I was going to say about the kind of gaps in services, sort of going back to the other question, is for those who are most vulnerable. I mean, one sense you could say any parent whose baby's died is vulnerable. But as I'm sure you know, the groups that are at higher risk are those that are classed as vulnerable, those in deprived areas. We know that domestic abuse is associated with increased risks of miscarriage and stillbirth. And as I'm sure you heard from Embrace earlier, certain groups, Black babies, Asian babies, are shockingly much more likely to die as well. And I think the combination of these, all of these groups finding it difficult to access support, particularly after the death of a baby, combines with the fact that there is very little understanding of what support is needed after a baby has died, given how many people are affected. One in four pregnancies ending in miscarriage and 14 babies every day dying in the UK. This is a massively hidden problem. And parents are, we've got sort of quotes from parents being told that their thoughts were unhelpful and they needed to get over it, that they'd not actually lost a loved one, and being told to come back to the hospital where their baby died in order to seek psychological support. Obviously having to wait long times, but also another, I just wanted to share this, she's mother saying, I walked out of the hospital, nobody ever contacted me. A letter from the GP congratulating me with the dates to bring my deceased baby for jabs and checkups. I called for counselling but was told I'd have to wait 6 months. I got no support. And endlessly the gaps are there for bereaved parents because they're invisible a lot of the time, and the groups that they represent or are more at risk are also invisible. So it's kind of a double issue, if you like. And I think there are massive gaps for these poor parents that need to be filled.
Claire, while you're talking about that, it occurs to me one of my colleagues, Angela Crowley, MP, is trying to get paid miscarriage leave, and I assume that's something that your SANS is fully supportive of.
Absolutely. And we're supporting her and we're working with her on that. And I think it's the very, very least that we can do as a society is to give parents that space. I mean, you never get over the death of a baby or the loss of a pregnancy in one sense, but actually being given the time and space that you need to start on that journey is absolutely crucial. And I think it's a kind of, you know, a society holding these parents at a time when they need to be held more than any other is so important. And yes, we're absolutely working with 100% behind what Angela is doing.
Thank you. Can I come to Fiona now?
It was just a minor addition, really, to what everybody has been saying in terms of these, you know, that we needed to understand more about the inequalities, I think, and that, you know, the groups where the special consideration really is needed in terms of the buildings and what help is available and how that's presented. But it was just really to emphasise the importance of really embedding experts by experience and service users in the design of any services, in the design of training going forward, and having that as an ongoing sort of dynamic process as well.
Thank you. A couple of colleagues. colleagues are going to go, come in with very specific questions on training. But Emma, you had a supplementary question before we move on to that.
Sure. Thanks, Convener. It's quite distressing to hear about what's happening as far as access for dealing with bereavement and stillbirths. I just had another thought about people who are new Scots, whose English maybe isn't their first language, and they are coming here and ending up, you know, going through our NHS in Scotland. What work is being done or needs to be done to support folk where English isn't their first language, or they're new Scots that are, having babies in our country?
Crucially, without family networks.
Yep, without family networks to support them.
Yeah. Would any of our colleagues want to come in on that initially? Maybe we'll go to Joanne first.
No family-based place to answer that, but there are those, everything that just reflects on the barriers to access that we really do need to do a lot more work around. And I would acknowledge that the programme board is making efforts to understand, you know, equality and diversity within service design through the creation of an availability and equalities framework. That work hasn't progressed at the pace that maybe we would have liked to see, but it's not surprising given COVID and a global health pandemic. But there are huge issues within our national care service in terms of the services not necessarily meeting the needs of the women that would most benefit from them. And there are a range of third sector groups, I'm a Birth Project, who you may have heard from, who are doing really important work to try and break down some of those barriers and to ensure that women can access local pathways to care. But the reality is that there are whole large groups of women who won't be able to access special support because help-seeking behaviour and self-care are learned behaviours, and actually we can't just assume that people are able to access the support. So if the referral pathways start with the GP, for example, we're assuming that people are seeking help from the GP or would proactively contact the local practitioner, when in fact we know that very often that's not the case, especially in more marginalised groups. So we do have to have those reach out services and the kind of step up, step down services to support families and to bridge that gap between the kind of community support that we currently offer, and also to be able to tap into that specialist care. I suppose you raise a really important point, Fiona, because the question is that we are expanding our specialist capacity, and that's a really significant advance. But currently, I don't think we can be confident that that expansion is going to benefit those women who are in the greatest need and who are managing the most complex range of traumas. So I think that we have ambitions to get better at this, but it hasn't been prioritised to date, and we could say it's an area where we certainly need to do a lot more.
Claire wanted to come in. Claire?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to flag up, I suppose, the importance, certainly for us, of translators in this area, because if a family member or a member of the community is involved, either it's highly inappropriate if a baby has died, and we've got a lot of instances of children having to be the translator and tell their parent, mother, that the baby has died, which is clearly totally inappropriate, but also instances where the community maybe has a different perception of either mental health illnesses or baby death, and actually then perhaps that it is not the right person to be translating and supporting. And so the importance of having a supportive translator who understands the issues, either baby death or perinatal mental health issues, and can not just translate but support in a really person-centered way, I think is crucial, because it's agonizing seeing children having to act as translators, and sometimes the community themselves have norms that they are expecting a mother or parents to respond to that are not always helpful.
Thank you for that. And Kat would like to come in.
Thank you. Yeah, I totally echo the need for translators. Also, recognising the cultural changes, you know, for a new Scots, I think it's more important than ever, really, the ease of access to these services. You know, if we had an ideal world, right, we would have a 24-hour helpline for parents run by the NHS where parents can phone up and it doesn't cost them anything and there's a translator if necessary and they can report any concerns at all, you know, be it like my baby's not sleeping or I'm not feeling, you know, the kind of smaller things before they build up to bigger things, because when they get to bigger things, then social services get involved and it becomes a question of, you know, as people's health conditions get worse, there's more the fear that their baby might be taken away, and that's compounded if you're speaking a different language as well. So I think it needs to be something really from the ground upwards. It's, you know, it should be acceptable for all parents to ask for help, you know, over the smallest things. Particularly these parents who are new Scots, they haven't necessarily got their family around them, their, you know, aunts and uncles and grandparents. They haven't got that. They haven't got free childcare. They need that kind of extra layer of support to kind of ask these questions when you're going through having a baby for the first time. You're not necessarily taught how to look after a baby. You know, there should be a really simple phone line, like, okay, just to ask questions so that they don't turn into the bigger things. But I know these things cost money and it should be, but it's something to think about.
Thank you for that. We're going to delve into workforce training in particular. I'm just looking at Stephanie would like to lead on that aspect of things. Stephanie?
Thanks very much, convener. Quite a lot of the women find that breastfeeding journeys actually have a huge impact on their mental health issues and, you know, talk about the need for support so that they can make informed choices on their individual circumstances. But a big thing as well seems to be really, you know, having that important, skilled, hands-on approach to breastfeeding, getting the right support from health professionals in that area there. And I'm wondering, what workforce training do you feel is needed to give really the practical support that women need with breastfeeding? Thanks.
Thank you. I don't know who would like to go in.
I wasn't sure.
But I'll take anybody that wants to come in on that, rather than pinpointing anyone. If you want to raise your hand, I'll come to you. Is it something that has been flagged up to us? As you say, infant feeding as a trigger to mental health issues, if that support isn't there. Joanne, can I come to you first?
It's not an area that we can lead on. So, to be honest, I don't think that I'm really well placed to answer that question, because we live in a membership organisation. Yeah, I would
just say it to someone else. Chat, Kat would like to come in on that. Kat.
One thing we are hearing from our volunteers who are seeing these women every week is that at the moment there's a disjoint between the narrative of breast is best And, you know, formula feeding being kind of not quite so good. However, if breast is best, there isn't the right support really for breastfeeding. So you're kind of getting this narrative of breast is best, but there isn't the support there. And breastfeeding is not easy, particularly, you know, if your child has tongue tie or just in even the easiest of circumstances. And so whether there needs to be more support for breastfeeding, yes, definitely, but also maybe the narrative needs to change slightly. Fed is best, isn't it? Really? You know, as long as your baby is fed and thriving, does it matter? There's so much judgment involved, isn't there? There's a lot of shaming around breastfeeding or not breastfeeding. And isn't it more important that the welfare of the mother is looked after so that she can make that choice of whether to breastfeed or bottle feed?
Can I come to Fiona?
Yeah, I was going to second that, really. I think it's a very emotive issue for most parents. And I think whilst there might be kind of ideals or wishes, I think parents need to be supported in the situation they're in. I think for many of us, it's perhaps not our direct remit, but we certainly do see the kind of consequences of women who feel very guilty about making one choice or another, particularly with those sort of interactions with medication issues. So I think this is an issue that, say, non-stigmatizing kind of education and support sort of from any professionals or other services in contact with women will be helpful to be kind of educated about and support women to make the best decision that they can actually in the situation that they're in. And it might be breast, might be bottle feeding, might be a combination. I think to help support women with what can be a very difficult, physically, emotionally kind of exhausting issue.
Thank you. Stephanie, do you have another question or will I go to one of
your colleagues? No, I just really wanted to thank people for their answers there. I realise that there's not anybody necessarily that has particular expertise, but just a small comment there as well. I would absolutely agree. A happy mum means a happy baby, and supporting mums to make the right choices for their circumstances has to be right at the top of that there. But I did just want to say as well, you know, there's huge evidence around the benefits of breastfeeding for babies that take them right through into adulthood as well. So I just wanted to say that.
Okay.
Thanks, convener.
Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, convener. What role does the panel think health visitors and midwives can have in prevention and proactively identifying people who are at risk from developing perinatal mental health problems? Does the panel feel that they have the training they need to do this? And could I put that to probably Kat first?
Okay. Joanne would like to come in on that as well. So we'll go to Joanne first and then we'll go to Kat, if that's okay. Joanne? We don't appear to be able to
hear you.
Sorry, we just had a little bit of a delay in putting your microphone live. So if you want to start again, Joanne.
No problem, thank you. I think the upskilling of the primary care workforce is a really critical first step in building these specialist services and embedding them locally. And I think that training for health visitors, but also GPs, midwives, maternity staff, really can assist with that early identification. It's absolutely critical that we have that local specialism, because the universality of these services, it can secure appropriate and timely referral, reduce admissions to inpatient care, reduce maternal deaths, frankly, and we really need to be prioritising the training of these primary care staff within our training plans. In Scotland, our ambitions are incredible and really far-reaching, but we do need to, you know, cut across accordingly, and we do need to think about where we could have the biggest impact. And I think it is getting that kind of primary care right and getting that local specialism right that can really drive up standards across the pathway. So I think it's really important that we prioritise that. And I think that there is good work underway. NES is obviously going to great efforts to develop online modules. But I think everyone is in agreement that it's not at a scale or a pace that would realise the recommendations in the Delivering Effective Services report. So we need to expand the workforce across all the tiers that I've mentioned there. And we also need to make sure that we are investing in the correct level of specialism within that workforce, because again, that really is critical to strip out the demand for crisis-led services and to prevent the year-on-year toll that we see in the Embrace report of maternal suicide.
Thank you. And Kat, and then I'll come to Fiona. Kat.
Midwives, GPs and health visitors have a massive role in, first of all, prevention of these various conditions, but also identifying them when they do come up. One thing which happened during the pandemic was, and this is really, really important, is antenatal classes were cut and they were just kind of put online. And not only are antenatal classes important in kind of educating the parents as to what's going to happen, also it's a massive preventative measure that you can use to prevent birth trauma as well. You know, much as we love the NCT, the NCT have a certain agenda when it comes to antenatal classes and vaginal births being best and breastfeeding being best. I think it's also important that that the NHS are able to provide proper antenatal classes as well, so that parents are shown the hospital environment. They're given all of the different scenarios that might come up. Yes, you might have a vaginal birth, but complications sometimes do happen. You might need forceps, you might need emergency C-section, and you know, being forewarned is forearmed in all situations. And if you're not prepared for a situation, again, that can lead to trauma. So antenatal classes can have a real role in preventing birth trauma, but also during the birth, there can also be preventative measures in place, enough staff being on duty at the time, enough staff being trained in how to pick up on certain vulnerabilities or more at-risk women or men. Also, I think there's an element of, in the NHS, there's, you know, as I was saying before, Dr. Jenny Patterson's report on traumatised midwives, traumatised women, in that if midwives are not given, you know, if their basic human needs are not being adequately supported, how can they possibly support birthing parents? And that can have a massive impact in preventing perinatal mental health conditions as well. Then there's after the birth, straight after the birth, there should be someone coming in saying, you know, saying, how did the birth go? How are you doing, mum or dad? At the moment, it's not really happening. It's all to do with, okay, is baby all right? Is baby thriving? I hear a lot from women who have just given birth that in the period when they're pregnant, it's all kind of like treating her like cotton wool, you know, this pregnant woman. And then as soon as she has the baby, it just suddenly like that, it's all about the baby and not about the mum. And suddenly all the focus is on the baby. And it's really, you know, the 6-week checkups from GPs pre-pandemic, they were already kind of not really properly happening, and they're completely not happening. You know, they haven't been happening over the pandemic. And when they are happening, because GPs are so so squeezed at the moment, it tends to be all about the baby and not about the mum. You know, how's your birth injury doing? How did the birth go?
how is your mental health? You know, that these questions are not being asked at the moment when they should be asked. And then health visitors as well, they're short-staffed at the moment. And so when we're hearing from a lot of women who are attending Juno groups, when they're phoning the health visitors aren't getting back to them. And when they are getting back to them, they're only given like 5 minutes or 10 minutes maximum. And it's generally all about the baby. They're not given adequate time for these questions to be asked, like, how are you, mum? and for the mum to answer. Unfortunately, it does come down to the same thing. It's short staff and also people not being trained in perinatal mental health adequately.
Can I come to Fiona?
Just a point to add that's through a perinatal OCD lens, really, that I think particularly health visitors could have a really crucial role to play with many things, but thinking about that in particular, because we know from the background literature, that postnatal period, particularly around kind of 6 to 8 weeks, is where the prevalence is really high in terms of lots of intrusive thoughts. And there's an opportunity there for lots of kind of normalizing information. I think the health visitors is really key. It's a non-stigmatizing a service, really, so that people kind of like be going to, you know, just check out something about the baby, but they have eyes on the mum as well before it could get to kind of engaging the mental health services and all that entails. So I think they are really, they need as much support as we can give them in terms of kind of their profession and being so well placed to offer that appropriate normalising or signposting where needed.
Thank you. And Clea.
Thank you. Yes, just some areas where I think additional training might be helpful. So sort of looking at healthcare professionals being able to identify the difference between grief and it going beyond grief and needing further specialist help, because obviously grief is a very natural response to the isolating bereavement of your baby dying. But there is a point where you then may need more specialist help, and that's often missed. And I think it's just easier to think, oh, well, it's normal to be sad, so we're not going to provide any more help. So I think that would be really important. I think wider training for all healthcare professionals in how to offer bereavement care after pregnancy loss and baby death. Because although midwives and especially bereavement midwives are brilliant at it, often these mothers' families are coming in through A&E or through gynae wards or in the community, and the care that they're getting there is not compassionate or good enough. Another area is those who are pregnant after loss, which is a particularly difficult time. And again, the health visitors, I think, often supporting mothers who are pregnant and have a new baby after loss, being able to understand the anxiety, literally minute to minute, day to day, about your baby would be really helpful. And then just finally, and this going back to one of the other conversations we were having earlier, about training, about looking out for the needs of men and of fathers and partners, because I think they are just often unable to acknowledge their feelings after a baby has died. They feel they have to be the strong one. They never feel that they should seek support. And in a survey we did a couple of years ago, 62% of men reported feeling suicidal because they were unable to say how, you know, devastated they felt and that they needed support. So I think if those four areas, training would be really useful.
Thank you. That's very, very helpful. We are going to move on to talking about particular challenges due to the pandemic. Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn.
Thank you for that, convener, and hello to the panel. Good afternoon. Obviously, we're in a really difficult period just now with the pandemic. We've heard a lot of evidence of how this has affected women. And I suppose my question is around, you know, have there been significant regional variations in a return to face-to-face services. And as we move forward and we're dealing with new variants, etc., how can we provide the most effective service, whether it's virtual or face-to-face? And could I maybe direct that question to Kat, please?
Hi. I may not be the right person to answer this because Juno is very much based in Edinburgh, so I can only speak for Edinburgh. But it does, even within Edinburgh, it does seem to be patchy when it comes to services returning, face-to-face services returning. Someone else might be more placed to answer that question.
Joanne Smith.
Hi there, thanks for your question. Maternal Mental Health Scotland is a kind of membership organisation, does have a geographic spread across the country. And in the early stages of lockdown, we did survey both local specialist perinatal mental health teams and also women's groups and peer support groups to try and gauge how well national policy has been implemented locally and also how it was being experienced by women. And I think it's fair to say that there was a buffer initially and perinatal mental health services were prioritised within the Scottish Government, and I think that that protected us from some of the worst effects that we've seen around this kind of the workforce maybe in England and elsewhere. So there was a prioritisation within policy. How it was being implemented locally was variable, unsurprisingly. And some areas appeared to make a smooth transition online and were able to more or less deliver their contacts to the same quality, but just virtually. Whereas in other areas, contact, we were hearing from women that contacts were as limited as a text message. So whilst that would be recorded as a contact happening, it's not actually providing any support to women in any meaningful way. So I think that there is that variability and that we need to go beyond what the data tells us has happened during the pandemic, because how that transition online has been experienced by different women in different parts of the country is variable. And I think that the offer of online support is irresistible in many ways for professionals, for some women, for local budget holders. And it works for some areas, but in many areas it's not sufficient, particularly where there's health protection concerns, for example. Health visitors, those frontline staff are absolutely critical in being that frontline identification and surveillance of vulnerable families and vulnerable children. And some of that richness of insight has been lost by the move online, but it is the kind of, inevitably it will become a, and it is becoming a significant part of our health offer to women. So my plea would just be that any decisions made around a move to online is based on the best available evidence.
Thank you. And Claire would like to come in.
Yes, I think just to say that obviously the pandemic has affected the way that bereavement care is offered, and that affects people's perinatal mental health. And I think one of the things that we have heard most, and this is both those who've been affected by baby deaths during the pandemic and those who are pregnant after loss, is the fact that partners haven't been able to attend appointments and scans, and that has caused enormous distress. And we've picked up quite a lot of mental health issues off the back of that. And I think the government encouraging everybody, all health boards, to allow partners back in has been implemented in very different ways by different health boards. And we are hearing that, you know, for in some areas, partners have been absolutely welcome back in, and in others, it's still not easy. And I think that does make a big difference if you have to hear the news that your baby has died when you're on your own, or you're, you know, you're having to attend appointments on your own. So just, yeah, just wanted to flag up that it feels very variable. But obviously, you know, staff are incredibly stretched, and it does depend on the estate for the health board as well as to what kind of rooms they have and what's available.
Thank you. We now move on to a question from David Torrance on access to services. David, I know you've been having problems with your internet. Hopefully it'll hold up.
Thank you very much for convening, and good afternoon to panel members. We've heard about variations in local services, but delivering effective services acknowledges timescales for perinatal mental health services. Are these timescales adequate? And I'll go to Joanne, please.
I think that the availability is variable across the country, and I think that there's recognition that the kind of current definition, pre-birth to 12 months, isn't sufficient because, you know, mental health difficulties can arrive at any time following the birth of a baby. So I think that that's my understanding, that the timescales are being reviewed, and that the kind of divergence across health boards is going to be brought together. But I think that timely and appropriate care is absolutely critical. You know, getting it right in the early years is well recognised as the most efficient and cost-effective way of improving outcomes across the life course. We've a wealth of policy in Scotland that recognises that. And we've got really strong foundations to build on. But there are kind of specific issues around our ability to adhere to timescales that have been exacerbated by the pandemic. So we have long-standing issues around recruitment and retention, which you've heard about in our universal workforce. These have been exacerbated by issues related to COVID and also Brexit, putting an undue stress on our universal services. So whilst we're seeing advances and specific timescales being introduced around these newly created specialist services, there is a risk that that fragile progress can be swept away by the demands that we're seeing on our statutory and universal services. So timescales are important, but we also have, they obviously don't exist in a vacuum. We have to be thinking about the ability of our universal services to intervene at appropriate, timely point and to provide appropriate and timely care. Otherwise, our advances in specialist care and the timescales that are associated with that will not have the impact that we hope to see.
Thank you. David, are you happy to leave it there and I'll move on to other questions, or do you want to come back in, David?
I've actually got one more question, and it's too clear, actually. It's around Claire, it's what input has the National Bereavement Care Pathway Scotland project so far had on increasing bereavement care and reducing local and national inequalities?
I think the idea was that it was going to be implemented initially in three sort of pilot areas, early adopter areas, and those areas made a very good start. As I say, they only had a couple of months before then going into the sort of lockdown and the pandemic. But already, I think the feedback that we were having, and we've done surveys both before and continuing from both the healthcare professionals and the parents in those sites, show that the experience of bereavement care was greatly, you know, increased. I think we are moving, instead of using pilot areas, because of the pandemic, to actually now encourage all health boards, there are 9 bereavement care standards that are part of the pathway, and to encourage all health boards to consider implementing as many of them as they can, because it feels that if we wait and do pilot areas as we go in and out of different waves, parents are not getting the benefit that we can see that they've had in the pilot areas. So Yes, I mean, I think it clearly makes a difference. I think the issues around workforce numbers and also the space and the room, all of which have been affected by the pandemic, are very real. And actually, we've spent a lot of the last sort of 6 months or so supporting staff who themselves, it is very traumatising if you can't provide the care to a bereaved parent that you want to. So I think it's had a, you know, a clearly, obviously, the pandemic's had a terrible effect on lots of people. But I think holding on to those 9 standards and doing the very best you can for all of them has really started to make a difference for parents in Scotland.
Just off the back of that, this is a good opportunity for me to ask a question that my colleague Sue Weber, poor Sue, has lost her voice completely. But I'm going to be that voice today, Sue. Sue wanted to ask Claire if it is normal practice in Scotland for mothers who've had previous baby loss for on their file for there to be a symbol. I think it's the butterfly symbol. Is that happening throughout Scotland?
So you're absolutely right that there is, in fact, it's a teardrop, it's a stands teardrop that goes on the notes, which indicates that there has been a previous baby death or pregnancy loss. So the parent doesn't have to tell their story again and again. The butterflies are really important for twins, for twin loss. So where there has been one twin who lives and one twin who dies, the butterfly is used on the cot to show so that anybody who comes up and can see a beautiful baby knows that there was another baby who died as well. And I think the butterfly is incredibly important because there are so many difficulties with the kind of the joy and the grief of one baby dying and one baby living. I think we are experiencing some challenges with electronic records and trying to work with Baginet and the various other sort of electronic systems so that there can be a red flag as well. But that doesn't seem to be working as well across the board, and we're sort of carrying on pushing that through because it just needs to be up there before you even say the first thing to a parent so that you're, you know, the tone and the approach of those conversations that you're having with parents is right. But yeah.
Thank you. Really Thank important. You for clarifying that. We have last questions from Stephanie on public awareness of the services that you, these third sector groups provide. Stephanie.
Thanks very much, convener. So first of all, I'd like to ask, you know, what gaps is it that exist in the information, do you think, provided by the NHS Scotland and the Scottish Government on perinatal mental health? And I'm not sure who wants to come in that one.
But we'll maybe just allow our panellists to raise your hand if you want to come in that first, and then I'll look to the chat box for anyone who wants to follow up. I don't want to put anyone on the spot, so volunteers are always better. She hinted. Claire, thank you.
Yes, I just to say that I think signposting is clearly really, really important, but it is really using at the moment. And I think if you were looking for the right support, and obviously a lot of people going online, whether it's after baby death or just for perinatal mental health support, if you're not feeling particularly like going through lots and lots of information anyway. And I think there is a key role for midwives and health visitors to help with accurate signposting, because otherwise it feels like you're battling yourself to try and find whatever support it is that's out there that's right for you that you can get. And the kindest thing we can do is to support those people to make, you know, to find the information that they need. So I think sort of skilling up midwives and health visitors so that they can signpost correctly would be enormously helpful.
Thank you. Joanne?
Yes, just to say that I do think we're quite good at providing information around perinatal mental health. And when the pandemic hit, the programme board did set up a virtual kind of rapid response hub to ensure that women had kind of timely and appropriate information and were being signposted to available services. So I think we're very good at kind of providing information. The difficulty is we have insufficient levels of service on the ground. From the perinatal and antenatal health fund that was made available for the third sector, that's providing support in 8 of the 13 health boards. There remains large parts of Scotland where women can access specialist support, and people, for example, in the North East, as I'm sure you've heard a lot about, are particularly disadvantaged. And we hear harrowing stories about women who do need to access specialist care but are unable to do so because it's hundreds of miles away and they have other children, they have financial barriers, they don't have social support, so they're not able to access that support. And we also hear of fathers camping in tents near mother and baby units because it's hundreds of miles from their home and they don't have the money to do anything else. Now, I know we do have the Family Support Fund, but again, there are real questions about the equity of that because it's £500 and if you live hundreds of miles away, then your expenses to stay in or around a mother and baby unit are significant. So we just say, I think we're quite good at information. It's always helpful to have that there and we appreciate the effort that's been put into providing that information, but what's really important is that we have services to refer women onto in this kind of critical life stage.
And as Joanne's, as you're speaking there, I'm thinking about people in the island communities as well have that added issue as well, which I'm sure we don't have any island representatives here. But can I come to Kat, and then Stephanie wants to come in with a final question. Kat.
Yeah, I would echo in island communities that there aren't those third sector organisations, and certainly within Edinburgh, a lot of work that we do within Edinburgh is signposting. We have a long list of local. Sorry, that's my cat. It's a local
cat
making a noise in the background. The other cat. There's a long list of kind of local and national services that we have on our website to signpost people to. However, even that is patchy because funding comes and goes, and it's a job to kind of keep that list up to date. So I think within the NHS, there could be a really good opportunity for health visitors to give that... for health visitors to be able to impart a lot of this information, and for kind of nationally, I suppose, somewhere for this information to be kind of kept up to date. I know there are various organisations like Health in Mind that have, like they try and keep things up to date. I wonder if there can be some sort of collaboration with the NHS with that. I don't know.
Thank you. Stephanie.
Thank you. Oh, we're echoing a little bit now. Thanks very much for those answers there. I suppose I kind of follow on from that as well. Certainly when I was speaking to the women, what I was finding was that actually the third sector services that they got were actually really, really excellent and a massive help and a massive support to them. But the biggest issue they seemed to have was the fact that that support came a bit too late and a bit too far down the line. And that seemed to be down to, you know, the information and the guidance around it that the health professionals didn't necessarily know about the local organisations that were kind of best placed to help them there. And the other point they made as well was about some of the literature that they get about terminology being outdated and a bit insensitive, talking about baby blues and things, which made them less likely to seek help because they kind of felt it undermined how they were feeling. So I'm just wondering from your own point of view, as far as third sector and NHS services go, how do we actually work together to improve that and actually get mums to the people that can offer the best support as quickly as we can, and maybe the national virtual hub as the way forward, as was commented earlier. Thanks.
So since this is the last question, I think I'll go round everyone just for your thoughts on that. Can we go to Joanne first?
Thanks. I think that kind of hits in the heart of the issue. It is about, you know, individual women require, have very distinct needs, and it's really important that we have a suite of services available that can support women and families and babies in a way that they require it. So I think it's right that there are real issues around terminology. I think in Scotland we've aspired to create this kind of multi-agency approach to supporting families, and it's absolutely the kind of the right thing to do. But it's complicated, and we have to begin to kind of break down some of those professional barriers between health and social care and begin to create space for meaningful collaboration and meaningful integration. So that women are experiencing a seamless service response rather than, you know, not feeling at home in any one of the kind of services that are being offered. If our services are not meeting the needs of women, then they're not fit for purpose. So I think that collaboration that we've aspired to, it's not going to happen on its own. We do need to kind of incentivise that, whether that's around shared budgets, maybe one way of doing that. Multi-agency training certainly is really helpful in doing that, and co-location of services in some areas might be appropriate to ensure that women are getting that wraparound care that they need and that they deserve. The NSPCC in Scotland has developed an integrated infant mental health service, multi-agency. It has seconded NHS staff, it has social work staff, it has third sector staff. And that's been trialling with tested out with a randomised controlled trial for 10 years in Glasgow. We await the publication of the findings of that in the next 2 years. It's actually an exciting example of how meaningful multi-agency services can work in practice. You do need to create space for different professional groups to develop a shared language, to develop a shared culture, to be operating using the same kind of thresholds and terminology as you mentioned there. So it's complicated work, but there's great examples of it happening throughout Scotland. I would reference the work of the Mental Health Implementation Advisory Group. There's real ambition to create specialist systems around families rather than any one type of care. And I think we really need to look at the best available evidence and be ambitious in our ask to create these local specialist systems to offer the best support possible to families, because we know that the return on the investment is massive.
Thank you. I'll come to Fiona next.
Yeah, so I think this is just to come back to the basics, I guess. This is a time where women and families are in contact with services for the maternity kind of experience. It's a time of increased risk and prevalence of a whole range of mental health problems. So it's a huge opportunity, and we can predict that, you know, we know a huge percentage of women and partners will be experiencing difficulties. So we do need to have that information and the wheels turning at a really early stage. So it's such an opportunity, isn't it, for prevention and early intervention, which, as I said, makes such a difference. So I think this idea of having the information there right from the get-go as to what services are available locally and kind of keeping that updated is absolutely crucial. And all the thinking that's going on today is obviously feeding into that.
Yes, thank you very much. And Claire?
Yes, I think the idea of a hub is, the idea of the hub is fantastic, because I think there needs to be a central place where everything is, so that you can find it easily, both healthcare professionals as well as parents and families. I think also there is something here about knowing what's happening with the kind of the very local area. So I think alongside the kind of a more national hub, there needs to be a way of sharing what's happening sort of on the ground, and particularly thinking about you know, some of your the Highland communities and the islands and how they can find. I mean, we have particular groups, for instance, in Shetland and various other islands, but they are often really, in fact, I was talking to one of them yesterday, how distressed they are that people still don't know that they're there offering face-to-face support on the island. So there's something about what's happening very locally, and actually healthcare professionals needing to know in their patch what is happening and what's available, as well as the bigger picture across Scotland.
Thank you. And I'll come to Kat finally.
Yes, early intervention is key. We know that some of these mental health difficulties are preventable, and that requires changes within the NHS, more staff, more trained staff, but also more more joined up approach between departments, and also between the NHS and third sector organisations. Another thing is, and it came up with, I was on a birth trauma working group recently with third sector organisations and the NHS. Something which came up was birthing people can forgive the NHS for being short-staffed up to a point, but at the end of the day, when you're going through a kind of very traumatic thing, really you need people to be kind to you, and if people around you are stressed and they're not able to look after their basic needs, and they are you know, stressed people tend to take things out on other people. Really, kindness costs nothing. And this is, again, what Dr. Jenny Patterson said in her report, and also Make Birth Better said in their report as well. Kindness and compassion, kindness costs nothing. Kindness and compassion are really, really, really key, as well as employing more trained staff as well.
I want to thank you all so much for your time this morning and for the help that you've given us in looking at the issues from your perspectives. That's the end of that particular session and our meeting. At the next meeting on the 14th of December, the committee will take further evidence on perinatal mental health, but will also undertake stage two proceedings, for the transvaginal mesh removal cost reimbursement Scotland bill. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.